first with time.
2 years ago, they met in Ann Arbor and provided one of the greatest moments in CU history.
Let's it go. He's got three people down there. The ball's up in the air.
Today, they meet again. Two teams back in the top 10, back in the national spotlight.
We are excited to be 2-0. We are excited that the nation's attention is coming to Boulder this weekend. It promises to be a great college football game.
Will it take another miracle to beat Michigan? It's the Bus and the Wolverines banging heads again in a Rocky Mountain rematch.
Are you ready for some football? About 52,000 fans here in Boulder are crowding in as we speak, filing into Folsom Field for the Rocky Mountain rematch, so the excitement is beginning to build in Boulder. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Tony Zarella. Thanks for joining us. What a day to be out here at Folsom Field. It is overcast, but the sun is trying to peek through, and they say the rains will hold off throughout the afternoon, which is good news. See you in Michigan head-to-head. It's just a great day to be out here. We've got a lot in store for the next 30 minutes, a lot to be excited about. Two top 10 teams head-to-head again, back in the national spotlight again. And the big question, how do they possibly top the last meeting 2 years ago? The other big question, how much will the Buffs miss this guy? Chris Anderson, sitting this one out, suspended earlier in the week after getting into it with Rick Neuheisel during the CSU game. He's not a starter, but he does already have one touchdown catch. Let's go down to Mike Hafner on the sidelines. Mike, how much will this disrupt things?
Tony, I don't think this will hurt the Buffs at all. Chris Anderson is a fine receiver, but the Buffs have the deepest and maybe most talented receiving core in the entire country. And one of these youngsters will step up and fill that slot that Anderson has missed. Well, there's excitement out here on the field, but maybe more out in the parking lot where all the tailgaters are going at it. Let's go out to Geneva Brew and see what's happening.
All right, Mike, I'm out here on the corner of Colorado and Folsom, and it's not college football without some tailgating. We'll be back in a little bit to talk to some of these guys. They're excited for the game. We'll hear what they have to say. Tony?
All right, Geneve, be careful. Well, a couple of minutes ago, we asked, how are they going to possibly top the last meeting? You remember, that was 2 years ago in Ann Arbor when they went down to the wire and provided the play of the year. Now, 2 years later, the Wolverines still won't talk about it, but as you would expect, it's still special around here, and it will always be remembered as one of the most memorable plays in Buffs history.
I mean, I can just remember Coach Neuheisel saying that this is going to be the greatest comeback in college history.
Time has run out. Stewart throwing it to the end zone.
Ball hanging up in the lights.
Ball's in the air. Caught! Colorado scores!
One play, a lifetime of memories. The miracle in Michigan, otherwise known simply as the catch. It didn't decide a national title. It was only the third game of the year. But Stewart to Anderson to Westbrook will go down as one of the greatest moments in Buffs history.
A win like that, I mean, you wish it never happens because it can give a lot of people heart attacks and, you know, and cramp up bad like I did the entire trip home. I couldn't celebrate too much, so all I could do was just smile.
That's easy to understand considering the comeback he directed. With 2.5 minutes left, 106,000 people in the stands, and a national TV audience glued to their sets, Cordell brought the Buffs back from 12 points down to shock the Michigan Wolverines.
It was fun, man. It was sweet.
You know, everybody's in the huddle. Everybody looked like we was just going to win the game. You know, we're in the huddle. Everybody's looking around each other. Blake, me, you know, Cordell, Ray, you know, all the defensive line, offensive line, Derek West. We're like, well, we're going to win this game.
Everybody's kind of looking around at each other, a bit wide-eyed. And, you know, everybody believed in it. We always believe, and it happened.
And Anderson helped make it happen. A little-used receiver, this was his moment. He didn't make the catch. He just made the catch possible.
I remember running down the field. It was great. And I got around one defender, touched, and just run down the field and look up, and the ball's coming right down on me. And, I just tried to get up for it and happened to get a piece of it, tipped it, and then Michael was in the perfect position.
Stewart to Anderson to Westbrook, just like they practiced it, only it never worked in practice. So why did it work in Ann Arbor?
We had a great group of players that year. I mean, it was a special team. And I don't think anybody really ever gave up.
If I were the defense, I'd have a few more guys over there.
When we were going down there, the defensive back didn't get a jam on me at all to slow me down. And that was a big mistake on their part.
Cordell drifted to his left, which gave ample time. Michael ended up going all the way around, so Michael got there almost last. And so Ray Carruth went up and Blake Anderson went up the ball caromed up back in the air and Michael was just there at the right place at the right time.
When the ball was tipped, I mean, there was just nobody else there but me.
Colorado has won the game! Colorado has won the game! Unbelievable!
And the rest, as they say, is history. 27-26, the Buffs couldn't stop celebrating. The Wolverines couldn't believe it.
You could have heard a pin drop in there. I mean, it just, you know, Blake tipped it and Westbrook came up and caught it. And from there, you know, I mean, the guy's got hands like glue and he's not gonna drop it. So everyone knew he caught it and then went the mad rush onto the field. And I mean, it's just kind of a blur.
I looked over to the Michigan sideline and Gary Moeller, I'll never forget this as long as I live, was in an absolute state of shock. And he kind of looked at me as if, how dare you celebrate after something so heartbreaking just took place. And I kind of had to empathize with him right then. I kind of wanted to maintain my decorum, so I kind of jogged. And then as I got out of his sight, went to full sprint to join the rest of us because it was wildly exciting. I mean, it's one of those things, you're lucky if it happens once in your lifetime.
An unbelievable moment in Ann Arbor 2 years ago. Again, the Wolverines won't talk about it. And Cordell, as you know, has carried his flair for the dramatic and the Hail Mary with him into the NFL. He's done it twice with the Steelers now. So he's 3 for 3, and he says, you know what? All due respect to Doug Flutie. I love Doug Flutie, but this play is mine. Who's going to argue with him? Well, stay with us. When we come back, it's back to the drawing board. Mike Hafner looking at the X's and O's of this year's matchup. And later, the Knights of the Round Table, Kisla, Kravitz, and Haven Moses, tackling one of the hottest issues in sports. We'll be right back. How much did it cost to go in?
Here comes Ralphie!
Yeah, Rick Neuheisel last night at the pep rally, and I was wondering, what do you think the Wolverines were thinking if they were in their hotel room watching television last night, watching the newscast, and thinking, you know, Rick Neuheisel really doesn't look too worried about us? I wonder about that. A little extra motivation maybe from Michigan. Well, truth be told, most are expecting the Buffs to light it up. They're 8.5-point favorites today, despite the fact that at least one poll has Michigan ranked in the top 10. We know how the fans feel. Let's go back outside to Genevieve Brew in the eye of the pregame storm. Genevieve, let me see. You've had 6 Jaegers, 2 tequilas. How you standing?
I don't think so, Tony. But you know what? It's not a college football game without some tailgating. And these fans have been having a great time. They've been, I don't know, they've been out here since about 10 o'clock in the morning. I've got a Colorado alumnus here, Gary. Gary, give me your truly impartial opinion on who you think's going to win today.
Well, it's no doubt about it. The Buffaloes are going to trample the Wolverines. There is no doubt about it. Number one.
That's what I thought, Gary. Thank you. Let's go over here and take a look. These guys, this is some high-class tailgating here. You don't got your hot dogs
green
and hamburgers
chili.
Here. What do you got here?
This green chili. We got barbecue beef, some guacamole.
So we got the guacamole. We got the green chili. We got the.
You guys are going to be going to getting up and going to the restroom often, you think, during the game?
We're like stout fans. We will not have to go. We're staying there for the Buffs.
You don't want to miss any possible Hail Mary catch. And real quick, well, I got some guys back here who were at the Hail Mary game, and they had a good story to tell. We don't have time, guys, but here you go. The Miracle of Michigan, he was there.
We were there.
Hopefully today it won't have to get down to that, and the Buffs will take a good lead going into the fourth quarter. Tony, back to you.
All right, thanks, Genevieve. You can see the Buffs running into the locker room. Their final time before the game will start. They'll come out in just a couple of minutes, maybe 10 minutes, as we close in on kickoff. You know, the Buffs have scored 85 points in their first two games, but nobody's talking about how many they've scored. Everybody's talking about how much they've given up. 53 points in the first two games against Washington State and Colorado State. Let's go back down to Mike Hafner on the sidelines. Mike, is that cause for concern?
I don't think so, Tony, and the reason is this. The Buffs' defense will be tested, but it's been the passing game the last couple of weeks that has hurt the Buffs, and Michigan does not throw the football. Still, this is what big-time college football is all about. Two major programs meeting on national television. Now, who's going to prevail? Well, let's take a look at how these two teams match up. Michigan and Colorado, two major football powers meeting on a September afternoon to see whose program will stay in the hunt for a national title. Michigan head coach Lloyd Carr knows he'll have his hands full. He's in enemy territory, and the enemy is ranked number 5 in the nation.
you know going in that it is not going to be easy, that you're going to have to play your best, that you're going to have to do the things that you do best well. And I think we know what it takes to win. Our challenge is to do it.
Rick Neuheisel is well aware of the winning tradition at Michigan. He knows the Wolverines will do what they've done for years, try to grind you into the ground.
This will be a hard-fought, slugfest-type game, you know, Midwest-style, hit-em-in-the-mouth type football game, and hopefully the strong will survive, and hopefully our summer weight gain training will pay off.
The Michigan defense is big, strong, and talented. They'll be a true test for the Buffs' wide-open offense.
They're one of those teams that's a solid team. They're fundamentally sound, and they're going to make you beat them. They're not going to give up a big play. They're going to maybe bend a little bit if you're playing at your best, but they definitely won't break.
The CU defense is no slouch when it comes to stopping the run. They're looking forward to the challenge of facing Michigan's best.
When a team comes and slams it up in there and bangs it up in there, if you're a middle linebacker, you got to love that. I mean, I think a lot of middle linebackers would say, hey, take passing out of football. Let's just run the ball every time. I mean, that's why you play the position.
Michigan must run the ball effectively to win. If they fail, the Buffs will have their way.
Colorado is truly a great team. We watched them on film. We studied them. They have a lot of great players, but we're very confident in our game plan and our style of play, and we're going to go out there and execute our game plan as our coaches told us to, so we're ready.
The Michigan defense has yet to see an offense like Colorado's. It's wide-open football with a flair for the dramatic.
I'm not going to put them down there. Their quarterback's a great player. Their running backs, and they have good wide receivers, and definitely their coaches is a great coach, and I think that this will be a good game.
The key to the game, can Michigan's grind it out style match the Buffs' dynamic air attack? The Buffs seem to have the edge, and that's why games like this make for great college football.
I think this is why you come and play college football, is to play the great teams and not play the weenies, you know? And you know, when you come to CU, you play a great team year in, year out, week in, week out. I mean, every single game on the schedule is a big team. So, I mean, this is a dream come true for the guys who come and play here.
You talk about a dream come true. This is what college football is all about. The fans here are electric. And Tony, if you want to pin me down about the CU offense against the Michigan defense, if they don't put pressure on Coy Detmer, then Michigan's going to see a lot of footballs in the air this afternoon, and it could cost them the football game. Back up to you.
Thanks, Mike. You don't exactly sound worried, and you probably shouldn't be. We're just warming up, you know. Norm's on the way in, as in Norm Clark, the TV debut of Norm's Notes. And when we come back, the mouths that roared with the hot topic, should the players be paid? That's this week's topic. Stay with us.
And Detmer's going back. Here comes pressure. He's throwing the screen. Lyndon Henry's got it at the 20, at the 15, at the 10, at the 5. Henry, touchdown.
Well, CSU stayed with him for a while, but eventually CU pulled again their sixth straight win over the Rams to improve to 2-0. The Michigan fans, as you can see, are well represented today. There are a lot of people wearing the maize. And you can see the band is not here, which is a disappointment, I think, for these fans. The Michigan band is not here. But again, the Michigan fans are well represented. And you look at the capacity crowds, and you hear about the big money from the bowl games, and it brings up the topic, should the players be paid? Is it simply enough anymore to simply play the game of football? Or do the players in college football deserve more? That was the argument overheard down in Lodo earlier this week.
If you listen to Bob, all I got to do is pay the players more. And then that'll get their motivation up, and we won't have to have this talk.
What's your problem? What is your problem with pamphlet? I mean, you got people. Don't choke.
I won't.
You can go into a sporting goods store and get a Coy Detmer jersey, and the school makes tons of money, and the NCAA makes tons of money. All this money's coming in, and the kids aren't getting anything from it. All I'm saying
is
give them a stipend. Why not?
Because it's not about
America.
The kids. It's about the game.
The kids make the game, though, Tony.
I understand,
but kids make the game. Well, what's disappointing for me, or to me, is that just that scenario. But there are a lot of situations where all of a sudden these kids are saying, boy, I've got to go home for family reasons. I've got to do something. They cannot get home. Exactly. So if they are denied that, then they're going to do some things that are probably not right. And it's,
if they feel like they're being taken advantage of, if they feel like they're slaves, then they're going to say, I'm going to get mine, whether it's
Don't pay them as a deterrent. Don't pay them as a deterrent. Pay them because it's fair.
You know what's fair? They have $100,000 worth of free education. That, to me, that's more than fair. If anything, let them get a job.
Tell me something. Now, what kind of education are they giving them? They're using these kids.
It's not even a question anymore whether they should pay them. It's just how they do it and when they do it. The perfect way of doing it is you have that playoff system that all the fans want and all the networks want because of the money situation. Then you give the kids, not just the kids that compete in those playoffs, but all college football players.
They're coming from backgrounds as well that they're very family-oriented. Most of them are being taken like from distances in terms of. I mean, they get homesick. They've got big families. They have certain things that they want to be able to enjoy. And then you're sitting in a dorm room around Christmas time or holidays. You can't go home.
You know what? Maybe I think I agree with Mark. It's the way you title it. Kravitz makes it sound like as they walk off the field, you hand them a check and say, thank you.
There was a time though where you press the $100 handshake.
Back in the 1950s, they had
San Diego State.
But they used to give them $15 a month, which was a pretty decent buck back then. So why can't you do it now with all the money? I'm talking $500, maybe $750 a month, so kids can afford to go out and get some decent clothes.
Exactly.
Unless they go to Nebraska where it's already paid for.
Then what about the idea that if you graduate from this college and on top of that you earn millions of dollars for this university by playing football, that at the end of your 4 or 5 years, if you pick up your diploma, we give you $5,000 or $10,000, then you take that and go out and buy a car with it?
These kids are not being prepared. I think that to me is the side that I'm very sensitive to, is that they go through this whole thing and they're not even prepared to go knock on a door or put together a resume or have the type of credentials that would at least get a door open to them for job interviews or an opportunity. Once they finish with football, they go back to doing whatever they did before.
I just think we got to be careful about turning these athletes into victims. I think if you're given a
chance.
No. I think that's not what I'm doing. I think it's if you're given a free education, it's incumbent upon you to do everything you can to take advantage of it. And if you don't, you're an idiot. All I'm saying is don't do it as a deterrent. Pay these kids because it's fair.
What we're saying here is they're doing so much beyond going to school that they deserve some money.
Then why not say, okay, it's a farce. Let's change the way it is. Let's say, okay, you know what? Then you don't even have to go to class. Just play football.
If you want to major in your specific sport and say, I'm going to go to college for a 5-year period. I can go to class. I can get my education if I want.
Or just play football.
Yeah, I think that would be perfectly fine.
Or give kids a chance to get some vocational training. Because a lot of these kids are just not prepared to go to the University of Colorado and to do that work. So give them an option of make it like the minor leagues and pay them and they're. Because this whole idea of guys playing for the glory of State University is just fiction. That's noble fiction. It's garbage.
Wow. Well, stay tuned. The arguing may not be over yet because coming up, predictions. And also, inquiring minds want to know. So as always, Norm Clark's going to find out the answers. Norm's Notes. Stay with us. Welcome back, everybody. A few notes on Michigan because the Buffs have a few ties to that area. Ty Bussey, the CU linebacker, who, as you may know, is battling leukemia, is back home in Detroit, but he is watching and he is rooting for his teammates. We want to say we wish him well. We should also tell you Rick Neuheisel has just shown his players a video message from Bussey, so it was an emotional scene in the Buffs locker room just a couple of minutes ago. Now the Buffs, as I speak, are inching their way up, peeking out onto the field, trying to find out what's happening. So they're caught up in the excitement and the emotions, as you would expect. Also, there is word here that former CU coach Bill McCartney and former Michigan coach Bo Schembechler are both here today and probably spending some time together. You know, McCartney used to work for Schembechler. Now, for the other interesting tidbits, let's check in with Norm Clark.
Tony, I didn't have to dig very deep for some tidbits on these two national powers. Here we go with Norm's Notes. Number one, CU has been magical on TV, winning 13 of the last 15 regional or national broadcasts, including that 27-26 win at Michigan.
Here comes pressure. He's throwing the screen. Lyndon Henry's got it at the 20, at the 15, at the 10, at the 5. Henry, touchdown!
Number two, Michigan quarterback Scott Dreisbach is 5-0 as a starter.
He's got the speed. It's touchdown.
Number three, this is Michigan's first regular season game in the Mountain Time Zone, and that rather surprised me, but I guess who would they be playing? Arizona, BYU, Wyoming, Montana? Number four, September is Michigan's month. The Wolverines have 102 wins, 25 losses, and 3 ties over the years in September. That's a winning percentage of .800. Number five, on the other hand, since 1985, CU has owned the fourth quarter. The Buffs have 83 wins, 4 losses, and 3 ties when leading after the third quarter. We could go on, probably talk this Buffalo's ear off, but let's get on with the show. Back to you, Tony.
All right, thanks. Norm Clark of the Rocky Mountain News. Well, it's time to put up or shut up. That means predictions. Back down to the field. Mike Hafner, what do you think?
Tony, I've looked at both teams, offensively and defensively, but I went to the number one source. There she is, Ralphie 3. And Ralphie and I both agree. The CU passing game gets 27 points, and the Michigan running game only gets 13. So I'm taking CU to win this game. Let's go out to the parking lot and Geneva Brew and her prediction. Geneva.
Hey, Mike, what a difference 200 Rowdy Buffs fan makes. There's nobody here. Everybody's inside. Kickoff's in about 5 minutes. I managed to finagle some food for myself and Mike, the photographer. My prediction, well, I think it's going to be a close game, and I say Colorado wins it about 27-24. Tony, back to you.
Thanks, Geneva. Nobody's going to pick Michigan, and as much as I love to argue, and I do love to argue, I'm not going to pick them either. I say CU by 2 touchdowns, 34-20. Well, they're about to kick it off. That wraps it up for us. Don't forget, we'll be back immediately after the game. Mike Hafner with complete postgame coverage from Folsom Field. But in the meantime, kick back, and from everybody at 7 Sports, enjoy the game. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you tonight on 7 News at 5 o'clock. Have a great day.
Football presents the Michigan Wolverines and Colorado Buffaloes. If you're gonna sell tickets, you gotta give them something to watch. Well, coming up is something to watch as we wait for the Buffalo and Buffaloes to come into the stadium. Colorado 2-0, ranked 5th in the national polls, one of the most successful football programs in the country over the past decade. This is showbiz. We'll be right back.
go into the cage. Keith Jackson, Bob Greasy, Lynn Swann is on the field. This is the land of the long ball in baseball for the Rockies. And both these football teams that we're going to watch today figure to use that long ball, and Michigan especially needs it.
Well, they do. Colorado is a team of big plays. On offense, they have a tremendous offense. But defensively, they do things that give you an opportunity to make some big plays. And for Michigan to win today, they have to hit their wide receivers on some big plays down the field. Defensively for Michigan, they need to put pressure on Coy Detmer.
Well, Coy Detmer is a master at improvisation. He doesn't care what it looks like, just move the chains.
Well, I love the way he plays because he just wants to win. He has thrown an interception this year. He is leading the conference in passing. But the thing that I like about him most is he does whatever it takes to win. And that's the way he does it. He is probably have the best core of wide receivers in the nation in the three wide receivers you're going to see here today.
On the defensive side, they're both pretty good defenses, Michigan in particular, and two of the best linebackers in the country will be on display today. For Michigan, it'll be number 37, Jared Irons, and for Colorado, number 16, Matt Russell. They're both terrific football players. Coming up in a moment.
Rick Neuheisel is the head coach of this Buffalo team. A lot of offensive firepower, Rick. Will you try and put a whole bunch of points on the scoreboard? Or would you rather control this game on the clock?
We want one more point than they have. But we're going to try to control the ball, do good things to keep our defense off the field. This is a very, very talented Michigan program. We know we're in for a slugfest right now. We just hope we come out on top.
You want a very aggressive defense. They've given up some big plays. Will they still play that kind of football today?
Well, we're going to live by the sword, die by the sword. We feel like we're playing great defense. We're going to hope to play some good offense and find a way to win.
Coach,
thanks,
thank you very
all
much.
Right, take care.
Kate?
Rick Neuheisel in his second season, 12-2. Lloyd Carr right there, the coach of the Michigan Wolverines, his second season. He's 10-4 after having been there for 15 seasons as assistant coach with the Wolverines program. And so here we go, playing on the rug in Boulder, Colorado, where the ball hangs a little longer and travels a little farther. Jay Feely will put it on the tee, a sophomore from Odessa, Florida, and kick it off for Michigan, and waiting to receive. And I think this tells you something about the Colorado people. They've got two true freshmen back there to handle the kickoff. Marcus Stickers, a freshman out of Dallas. Ryan Nunez, a freshman from Austin.
And those two freshmen, Keith, were two of the top freshmen in the state of Texas last year.
So they brought him in. They said, you're supposed to be pretty good. Show us. The kids did in practice, and there they are. One of the biggest games they've ever played in their young lives. Sideline to sideline. Leave no cracks, and here's the kick. It's a hooker going down toward the corner, and it's taken 2 yards deep in the end zone by Stickers. He's to the 20, across the 20, 25, 27-yard line. You kind of hold your breath when you got that kind of foot speed on the field. The starting quarterback for the Colorado Buffaloes, wearing the home black, is Coy Detmer. You see the amount of yards that he has accumulated as a result of his passing, mainly in his 7 games as a starter. He was injured early on last year. When he was injured in that game, fourth game last year, he was leading the nation in passing efficiency.
Yeah, exactly, Keith. He was tearing him up.
Hershel Troutman is the tailback, 190-pound junior from Naples, Florida. And Detmer keeps the ball on a rollout. Throws, and he's got a man wide open. It is Phil Savoy, junior from Washington, D.C. And moved the chains as Detmer rolled out. He had a convoy, and Savoy was wide open. Here's Chili's backs and receivers, the starters for Colorado. Ray Carruth, number 21, is the speed burner, but Savoy is becoming a primary target. James Kidd, also a wideout and very fast. From the 48-yard line, first down Buffaloes, they run it. Taken down by number 28, Adrian Taylor, but he's on the Michigan side of the field. The offensive front had some severe losses through graduation. Chris Nioli is the bell cow of that bunch. The big guy, number 53, there at center, is also terribly important to them because he replaced a very good player in Stoltenberg.
But it's Nioli who leads that offensive front.
Nine starters return on this offense, Keith, and the only two starters they lost were in the offensive line.
So it'll be second down and about seven. Coy Detmer whips it, intercepted, dropped. Charles Woodson had it. They're going to give him the interception. He dropped the ball and Taylor covered it. So Woodson, who has blazing speed himself, might have turned, might have lit up the scoreboard with that one, but he was running before he had it.
That's the first interception of the year. And you see what Neuheisel's talking to him about. He's talking to Savoy. Savoy goes down and just kind of hooks up. Five-step drop. It's a slant pattern. He throws it in front of him. Savoy had stopped, and then he moved to try and get it. It's the first interception for Detmer after 78 passes. Going back to last year.
Michigan is now in business. You turn it over, get penalties, little tiny mistakes, sometimes a big mistake, then you're whipped. Charles Woodson is on the field as an offensive player, and timeout is called as all kinds of things were going on, and Dreisbach didn't like it. He said, wait a minute, let's talk about it. All right, order's been restored here. They were not able to cash in for a quick strike. Got Dreisbach. His yardage numbers are relatively small in his 5-0 record, though, as a starter. And three interceptions against four touchdowns. But today they need some long ball. They need some 30-yard passes. Charles Woodson is on the field, shifting now out of the tailback position and going to a wideout. And he's over here against Marcus Washington. And Dreisbach looks and lets it go, trying to throw the ball for Woodson, and the pass is long and out of bounds, incomplete. So they were trying to get the speed of Woodson on a fly pattern down the side of the field, and it didn't work.
They didn't get the coverage they were looking for, Keith.
The backs and receivers, Chile's starting lineup for Michigan, Ty Streets and Charles Woodson figure to be the people that have to make some big, long plays. Now, Stan Parrish told us last night that they've been working on some 20 to 30 yard patterns. They need some stuff down the field. They need to stretch Colorado vertically because it's a very aggressive defense. This is Clarence Williams carrying. He had the tailback work all to himself last week. This week he's got help from Chris Howard, who is now academically eligible for the season. Rod Payne is the center. He anchors the offensive front for Michigan, and it's a good offensive line, and it needs to be because they're looking at some pretty tough defenders.
Yeah, it'd be a good match today. Payne is a preseason All-American against the inside linebacker Matt Russell for the Buffaloes.
After the run by Williams, it is third down and three. The ball is at the 42-yard line, and Williams is the single back. Four-man front for Colorado. Give it to Williams. He bounces outside on good blocking, puts his shoulder down, and gets the first down against Marcus Washington as he gets up around midfield. So Michigan moves for the first down in its first possession, coming off the interception of Coy Detmer.
Watch the center, 52 Payne, and Russell, number 16. Both preseason All-Americans. Russell kind of gets hung up there in the confusion, in the trash, if you want to call it, that all these players in there, I used to like to call them that, but not to their face, I didn't. But all in the confusion, and the back got around for the first down.
First down for Michigan at the Colorado 49-yard line. Wolverines on the Colorado side of the field as Dreisbach changes the play at the line of scrimmage. Sets up pressure. Complete. The hit is on number one, Tyrone Butterfield, by Marcus Washington, and it was close to being early, but he got away with it. Now let's go to John Saunders in New York.
Keith, for the second consecutive week, Northwestern has to go into ACC country. As you know, they lost last week to Wake Forest. This time around, it's Duke. Darnell Autry on the opening drive busts a couple of tackles, gets the touchdown, 30 yards. They missed the point after, though. 6-0, Keith.
Okay, John, it's second down and 10 at the 49 for Michigan on the Colorado side of the field. Here comes the blitz. They pick it up, give it to Williams. He runs into the traffic and will pick up maybe 2 yards.
Defensively for Colorado, the four down guys are Greg Jones. He's the rush man. He's a good one. Viliami Maumau is a 300-pounder. Ryan Olsen, 275 inside. Nick Ziegler is only a sophomore at the other defensive end position, but he's a good one. The linebackers, Phillips, Russell, Merkerson. It is Russell, the man that everybody talks about. I mean, he's a hammer. And the secondary, Ryan Black, is a blitzer.
Well, he was, and he was blitzing that last time, Keith. This defense blitzes a lot. They're very aggressive, which gives single coverage in the secondary and an opportunity to make some plays.
Time is called by the Buffaloes at 12:26 to go in the first quarter, and there's no score. Michigan looking at third down and 8 on the next snap. College football on ABC Sports brought to you by the new Dodge. We're thinking ahead. Kellogg's, with a good taste, nutrition, and value, the best to you each morning from Kellogg's. By Miller Lite, when you've got the great taste of an ice cold Miller Lite, life is good. And Chili's Grill and Bar, home of the Big Mouth Burgers. All right. Matt Russell looking around, counting his folks on the field on the stop side of the ball, and he counted 12. That's what precipitated the timeout. Third down and 8. No score here in the first quarter. Reisbach back to throw. Now a little pressure coming. Gets it away and throws it away. Incomplete. Penalty flag is thrown against number 57, Nick Ziegler. Ziegler hit him a little late.
That's a big mistake for the Buffaloes. The play was well thought out by the Buffaloes. They had it defensed, and you're going to get a roughing the quarterback call. As you see, A.J. Kristoff right there just cannot believe it.
I mean, there, Michigan's headed for the punt on 4th and 8.
Michigan rolled right. They wanted to throw back to the left side. It was well covered. Dreisbach threw it away, and at the very end gets hit. Watch this. Everybody, all the receivers are the right side. It's a tight end delay. Watch number 80, the top left of your screen. He's going to drift back to the left. Coverage is there. So he throws it away.
He jumped on top of him. That's what did it.
Yeah, the end of it.
Yeah, he pushed
Big
him down.
Mistakes.
It was all right. But when he jumped on top of him, that was pretty easy.
Look at this, Keith. The last two games, the first two games, Colorado has averaged 11 penalties and 3 turnovers.
That'll get you beat against Michigan.
That's 22 penalties they've had already this year in 2 games.
Chris Howard is the tailback. First down for the Wolverines up the Buffalo 33. Setting up a screen here, and it is completed to Chris Howard, the tailback, a junior out of River Ridge, Louisiana. And he's at 214 pounds. He's a bigger running back than Clarence Williams. And obviously a little stronger.
So he's like Leroy Horde, the old halfback that used to play with the Wolverines. But that last penalty against Neuheisel's Buffaloes was like a turnover, Keith, because Michigan would have had to give the ball up. Yep. Now they continue with the drive.
Second down. Long one with Howard still in the backfield. He's got the ball, and he's got the first down. He's going to get down to about the 21-yard line. Again, let's go to John Saunders.
Keith, BYU against Washington. Also an opening drive touchdown. Rashawn Sheehy from 4 yards out bumps one guy and then just gets it across the plane. And right now, Washington leads BYU 7-0. Keith.
That's in Seattle.
That's a tough place to go as a visitor and win, Keith. Maybe one of the toughest in college football. Here are the game stories for Michigan. They need big plays versus the Colorado blitz. And on defense, they need to put the heat on Detmer. Detmer makes the offense go.
First down at the 21-yard line of Colorado. Michigan ball. Howard's in the backfield. Bigger back. We've got Woodson wide to the right. He's going both ways today. Dreisbach looking and throwing to the corner. Incomplete. Pass intended for Ty Streets. Number 86 covered by Dalton Simmons. That was not even close.
Well, it was covered, and good job by Simmons. Simmons missed last year with a knee injury and is really not all the way back. In talking with some of the coaches for the Buffaloes, they feel like he needs to be in there because he is one of their better defensive backs, but he's just playing himself back into shape.
Number four, Russell Shaw, has come into the ball game. Junior college band Tyrone Butterfield is also out there to wide out, and Clarence Williams, the running back, went into the stack and is going to lose a yard. I mean, he may have been trying to skip a step and bounce off the stack, but he didn't give it much of a chance. Matt Russell and Mike Phillips just ate him up.
The Buffaloes were blitzing, Keith. A.J. Kristoff, the defensive coordinator, likes to be aggressive defensively. He says his players like it. They react well to it. And that time he blitzes about one-third of the time. And, you know, if you're playing a type of team like that as a quarterback, Keith, you enjoy that because there's some opportunity to make some big plays.
10th play of this possession, third down and 12. Run it up the middle, give it a Chris Floyd, the up back, and Floyd is belted down at the 19-yard line. It'll bring up fourth down, and here comes the kicking team. So the Michigan offense bogged down as it gets downfield when Dreisbach tried to lock up and stay with Streets all the way, and they shut him down on that. Remy Hamilton had two kicks blocked, remember, against Illinois. Holding is Brian Greasy. The snapper is Mark Bolak. The kick is away. Looks good and is good. And so Michigan, helped by Colorado mistakes, cashes in a 37-yard field goal try and takes the lead 3-0 with 10:33 to go in the first quarter. Monday night, Al Michaels will host an action-packed primetime special showcasing the greatest moments of all time in sports, including Cal Ripken Jr. breaking Lou Gehrig's consecutive game mark. And then Jim Kelly and the Buffalo Bills. They're at Three River Stadium to avenge last year's playoff loss, they hope, against the defending AFC champion Pittsburgh Steelers on ABC's NFL Monday Night Football. Monday night here on ABC.
That ought to be a good one. Steelers have got some players banged up, but they seem just to put in some new guys and they just keep going.
Feely, the last time, reached the end zone with his kickoff 2 yards deep, and Stickers brought it out. Stickers and Nunez are back there again. High hanging kick, well back into the end zone, and we know to turn this time. It'll come to the 20 for the Buffaloes, where it'll be first down. 10:33 to play in the first quarter. On the field, we'll set the Michigan defensive alignment for you. They're led by William Carr at the down position, the nose tackle, and he's a very good one. But right behind him is one of the better linebackers in the country, Jeremy Irons. He had 15 tackles in the game against Illinois. The secondary, Charles Woodson, was the freshman player of the year last year in the Big Ten. It's a relatively young group back there, but they're quite good. This is Chapman bouncing around and finally getting to the outside a little bit and getting back to the line of scrimmage, and that's all he's going to get out of it.
There was a Michigan defender that came up and had a clear shot at him, and the sword, number 93, he just said, whoops, I'm going the other way. For Colorado, it's Coy and the boys. Detmer is one of the best in the land. He's got a great set of receivers to throw to, and defensively, you got to limit those plays, the big plays, to the wide receivers.
It is second down and still about 10 for the Buffaloes, and Detmer directing traffic, sends Troutman outside on a little quick pop, intercepted and dropped. Oh my goodness. Marcus Ray had a touchdown, a gift, and he dropped the ball. He was trying to run before he had control.
What happens here is the Buffaloes empty the backfield. When Michigan saw that, they blitzed. When Detmer saw that, he hit the hot receiver, who was Kidd, number two. And Michigan has been well prepared for this. They knew where the hot receiver was. He went to where the throw was going to be. He just couldn't hang on to it.
Oh, he'll kick. Yeah, I hope he doesn't have a dog at home.
I mean, that was two good plays. one by the defense and one by the offense.
Third and 10. Detmer rolls it out. Pressure coming. Pass is away. Pass is completed. On the dead run, he threw a bullet to Savoy. That's what Detmer can do, but he took a lick and he gets up rubbing the right knee. But he's walking all right.
Well, that was not designed to be a rollout, Keith, and there you take a look at his knees. Not designed, but he got a little pressure and he felt that he could get out to the right side, and his mobility throwing on the run, that's just a plus, and that's just something that's tough to contain this young man.
This is Trotman, caught from behind by Sword 93, and Irons meets him at the front end. So the linebackers do a job here with Mr. Carr always around the ball. But there's some gain on the play, as Trotman is a very elusive fellow in traffic. Gained about 4 yards. Joaquin Fizell, number 90, is now on the down group for Michigan. Second down and 6 for Colorado. Detmer keeps it and throws down the middle for the tight end, Lepsis. He's got the ball. He's got the first down for Colorado at the Michigan 44.
Colorado runs this play so well. It's two tight ends, two wide receivers, and one back. It's a fake to the remaining back and a little rollout, which gives you a little more time. Both tight ends are coming across in the same direction as the quarterback. The flow of the quarterback is really flare control.
Well, they put him down on the ground each time, though.
That's important to do early in a ball game.
Yep.
Just get to the quarterback.
Make him get up.
Make him think about it.
Yep. There's that little quick pop. Kid is hit almost instantly and taken down to the ground by Woodrow Hankins. Woody got him quickly. You got to get Kid quickly. Boy, you let him get upfield and you won't see him again.
You got that right. Like 4.4 speed, a little less than 4.4, and he's not very big, 5.8 and 160. And not only the excellence of the receivers, and they've got four of them. One of them is suspended. Chris Anderson is not playing today, but the speed of them. Carruth, the preseason All-American, has run a 40 and 4.2. So they've got some quickness at wide receiver if they shake loose.
Second down, 6. Trotman, the single back. Kid at the top of the screen. Savoy at the bottom. Carruth is slot. Whistle stops him. They may have burned the play clock.
Dead ball. Delay of the game. Still second down.
It's a big eight, It's a big 12 crew. I'm probably going to say that several times this year. It's a big 12 crew with a referee, Terry Turlington. So he marks off 5 against the Buffaloes, and that'll take him back out there to about second down 11.
Rick's on the phone upstairs to his offensive coordinator, Carl Durrell, and between them, they make the calls and send him into Detmer. But I got a feeling that Rick makes most of the calls.
Back goes Detmer, has time, throws underneath, tied in, and he's got Lepsis again. He's a big target, 6'5", 260, fifth-year senior out of Frisco, Texas, taken down by Clint Copenhaver of Michigan. If you want to know where Frisco is, it's down in the Houston area.
And Lepsis may be one of the top tight ends in the country, Keith. He is, you probably mentioned, 260 pounds. He has caught 35 passes in his career, runs a 4.75, and the tight ends mean a lot in this offense. You know, the wide receivers get a lot of the acclaim in the quarterback, but the tight ends, they had a good tight end here a couple of years ago, Christian Fourier.
They've had 2 penalties and 1 interception, however, in the first 8 minutes, and Detmer doesn't like something, so he calls timeout at 6:38 to play in the first quarter. Michigan leading by a score of 3-0. I told you the referee was Terry Turlington, Big 12 crew. There are the rest of the guys: Ron Johnson, Fred Hutchinson, Steve Stelius, Steve Cook, Greg Burks, and Mike Weir. The Big 12, huh? It's going to be a significant conference.
Coy has started off 5 of 7, 60 yards, and 1 interception was not his fault. The receiver didn't continue running, and he just let him. But Michigan is a bend don't break type of defense.
Third and seven, the pressure coming, the ball is thrown, and it's out of bounds and complete. Again, though, that's what Detmer will do for you. He knew he was going down, had a little chance to complete it. He put it where nobody could catch it. William Carr is the man who put him on his back. And Andy Mitchell is in to punt for the first time today for the Buffaloes. Mitchell is a junior out of Littleton, averaging 47 and a half yards on six punts so far this season. Chuck Winters is waiting for it. Chuck is a defensive back. High spinner. It's a tail dragger, though. If it doesn't reach the end zone, they'll have to catch it, and they do. So Colorado does the smart thing. They simply went down there and caught the ball. But didn't give it a chance to bounce into the end zone, and they've got Michigan backed up. Michigan, if you remember the Illinois game, had three guys down there, and they couldn't down it inside.
Right between their legs.
Tomorrow night on ABC starts with an hour of America's Funniest Home Videos. Then Sandra Bullock, Demi Moore, and Courtney Love, guest on the Barbara Walters special. And Denzel Washington and Emmy winner John Lithgow star in the Sunday night movie Ricochet. That's tomorrow night here on ABC. Chris Howard comes out at the tailback position now for the Wolverines, number eight. Didn't play in the first game of the season. He has the ball, sliding to the left, pops loose, gets up across the 10-yard line before Steve Rosga, the fifth-year senior and the leader of that defensive secondary for Colorado, brings him down.
Steve Rosga on the tackle.
Rosga is leading the Buffaloes in tackles after the first two ball games. In fact, both safeties are. Rosga and Black are tied with a number of tackles.
I liked his hairdo when I saw him yesterday.
Yeah. He's got it all stuffed up underneath there, I think, today.
It wasn't any. He shaved it.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Cut it all off. This is Chris Howard. Up across the 20 for the first down, and the Wolverines now running the ball have moved out of trouble.
But one of the trademarks for a Michigan team, and Lloyd Card wants to continue it, is that they're physical and they want to run the football. They want to come in and take advantage of some opportunities on the outside by throwing to the wide receivers, but they want to run the football, control the time of possession, and keep Detmer and his offense off the field. Dreisbach has not completed the pass as yet. He's 0 for 3.
Clarence Williams is the tailback now as Howard comes out for a breather. Williams taken down in a hurry. There was a black shirt that penetrated quickly and wrapped him really before he got to the line of scrimmage. It was 56. I think Ryan Olsen came from the left side, forcing him back inside, and he ran right into Viliami Maumau. He said. Down he went. Kathump. Viliami is a daddy boy from Honolulu, and I'm going to tell you.
You'll say that as long as you're up here, but you get down next to the 300 pounder, you won't be saying that.
No, he's a horse. This is Howard. And the Buffalo stunting ate him up.
Watch Matt Russell and Rod Payne at number 52 is going to come out and block him. The running back just cuts right back at Russell. It's good defense, team defense, and Russell was where he was supposed to be, and that is filling the inside gap.
Williams comes back now at the tailback spot. Russell Shaw is on the field, a good receiver. High Street is the top of the picture. Dreisbach gives the ball away to Williams, trying to get to the outside, nothing doing. Cut it down by Marcus Washington, a cornerback. Loss on the play, back to the 25, and now Michigan will have to punt it. As the Colorado defense really went to work.
And very conservative offensive play calling. We said Dreisbach has not completed the pass. Dan Parrish told us yesterday that they wanted to get him off to a good start with some short, easy completions. Well, that hasn't happened.
Paul Peristeris is in to punt. He's had one kick for 47 yards. And gets this one out. High spinner. Good hanging on the kick. Fumbled. And covered by Ryan Nunez. Oh, my goodness. Every Colorado heart went right to the Adam's apple on that one.
Well, both squads, their special teams have been questionable. Colorado gave up a kickoff return for a touchdown last week against Colorado State, and Michigan's special teams haven't been the finest either.
31-yard line after a 45-yard punt by Peristeris, and here comes the Buffalo offense onto the field with Troutman as your tailback. Double wide, top of the picture. Detmer gives it to Troutman, coming back to this side. Got a terrific block and breaks clean, and is dragged down at the 45-yard line. Adrian Taylor saved six. He might very well have scored if Taylor doesn't get him.
From behind the defense, this play starts off and supposed to go to our left side, and he just has great vision and the feet to get back all the way over to his left and get with his speed, get around the corner for 25 yards.
Just inside the 45 of Michigan. First down, Buffalo. Denver still got it. Pumps it out here to the left side. Pass good to Tennyson McCarty, the tight end, who had flexed out to this side, and he makes the catch down to the 38-yard line. And a pickup of about 7 yards.
What Detmer and Neuheisel know is that Michigan is more of a containing defense. They're not as aggressive as Colorado, so it's more containing. You're not going to get the easy big plays maybe that you've gotten the last couple of games.
3-0 Michigan leading, 2:50 to play first quarter. We're at Folsom Field in Boulder. Detmer back, looks, gives it to Troutman. He was looking for some place to go, and Wolverines didn't give him any time to make any quick decisions because Ben Huff and Jared Irons were right there. He'll lose back to the 40. And it'll be third down and a long five.
Here's a look at Jared Irons. His father, Gerald, played in the National Football League for, I think, 14 years.
Yep, 14 years. Yeah, they've raised a nice young man.
Yes, they have. He is a quality young man. He rooms with Rod Payne, and they're like direct the odd couple. Irons is neat. Payne is, I guess he's not.
Detmer. Gets it away, and it is incomplete. No, sir, it was on the ground. Bill Savoy almost reeled it in, but Adrian Taylor, the sophomore out of Longview, Texas, got just enough of him and the ball to keep him from catching it. 1:59 to go, first quarter, and the Buffaloes will have to punt on fourth down. Mitchell's first kick was a 37-yarder. It was downed at the 4.
This kid Mitchell, Keith, is considered a top NFL prospect. He's just an underclassman, though.
Well, he needs a little more consistency.
Yeah, he's had a couple blocked in the past, too.
Yeah, he's got this one hanging up there, but it gets a great bounce. Oh, what a play! What a terrific play by Marcus Washington. He knew full well when he caught the ball that his momentum was going to take him in. He just flipped it back to a teammate, and they put it down on the 1 yard line.
That is just great special teams play. You work on this and you work on it all the time, and sometimes you get it right and sometimes you don't. These are just young men. Watch him now. He knows he's falling in, so he keeps it out. That's just great thinking and great play by Washington. And a good punt, too. The ball cannot break the plane, and you cannot, as a player, have the ball and touch into the end zone.
All right, Michigan started back on the 4 the last time. Weisbach tries a little sneak, trying to get a little room, and I don't think he got much out of it at all because the middle of the Colorado defensive unit just collapsed on it.
Well, there's Bob Houck. He's the special teams coach, and he's got to be very pleased with his unit so far. They've backed Michigan up inside their 10-yard line on the last two possessions.
After the 2, second down and 9 with Chris Howard in the end zone. Trying trying to avoid any kind of a mistake. When you start pitching the ball around or handling it around down in your own end zone, it's a little, it'll tighten your stomach.
Well, the thing you'd like to do, obviously, here offensively is pick up a first down or one or two first downs, get some field position back before you punt the football.
Third down and about eight.
What Colorado wants to do defensively is hold them, force them to punt, and then continue that last offensive drive, maybe from inside midfield.
Go long right here. Go long right here. There it goes. It's Ty Streets out there, and he can't reach it. It was a foot too long. And now they'll punt.
Play action. It's third down. Dreisbach is going to fake good. He's going to get the ball off, but watch just as he gets rid of it. So they are knocking him down. Jones 59. And that adds up over a period of time.
So Peristeris is standing right against the back of his end zone. Ball's going to be snapped from about the three. Well, that's tight quarters down there. Pressure come? No, they don't get any pressure on it. The kick is away, and it's a pretty good one. Block thrown upfield that almost turned him downfield by Damon Dickey, one of the strong safeties. But the Buffaloes do what they wanted to do. They pin Michigan back, and they've got a man hurt on the, Wilbon is hurt on the field. They get the ball at the 40-yard line of Michigan. Alan Wilbon is a linebacker. And he was involved in the kick in the kicking team coverage and the blocking, and he took a lick, but he's going to walk off. That special team stuff, you got to be a tough dude to get out there with.
Oh, it does. And what it just set up the offense with the punt inside the 1 yard line. Now the defense held for three plays. Now the offense is right back out there continuing this drive with great field position.
Here's the Buffaloes big back, Lyndon Henry, 210 pounder from Fort Arthur with the ball. Walks it right up the middle and picks up close to 5 yards, down to about the 35 yard line. Henry had a big ball game against Washington State. It was Troutman who had the big game against Colorado State last week. We played one. It's 3-0 Michigan. We go to the second quarter. Colorado owns the football just short of the Michigan 35-yard line. And Michigan leads the ball game by a score of 3-0 on a 37-yard field goal. Second down. And about six. And the Wolverines try to puck inside, find the blitz, got picked off, but they manned the fort very well as Marcus Ray pops in there to make the tackle on Henry. And there's a loss of about a half a yard or so.
Well, they were blitzing, Keith. It's a good point. Take a look at the first quarter stats. Score is 3-0. The yardage in favor of Colorado. Take a look at the bottom, the last stat down here. Average starting position. Michigan twice has started within their own 5-yard line, and Colorado's had much the better of it. That one turnover didn't lead any points, but it was a penalty.
Third and six. Detmer underneath. Troutman gets his first down. Hard guy to get a hold of. He's 5'7", 190. First down Buffaloes, Michigan 25.
It's just a nice call by Rick Neuheisel and Carl Durrell. They've been throwing to their wide receivers, and they've been tight man-to-man coverage and not being able to get him the ball. So he swings his back out of the backfield, throwing against a linebacker. You get Troutman and one of those quick backs against a linebacker, and you're going to pick up some yardage.
William Carr came off the field holding the upper part of his leg, his right leg. So Carr's not in there right now. Rob Rennes is in replacing him, a redshirt freshman. Detmer 7 out of 11 for 77 yards. He's been picked one time. Almost picked twice, actually. They held on to it. On first down, Coy throws again, setting a screen. And it's Henry inside the 15 to the 13.
Detmer sets these things up so nicely, Keith. The threat of the deep pass is always there, and they always know that the team that plays zone, and you drop your linebackers off, you can always get the screen pass started, at least with your halfbacks, and that's what they did.
There's Carr off the field, shaken up, being attended to, double tight end alignment now for the Buffalo. Six different receivers have caught the ball. And Detmer hands to Henry. He's hit behind the line of scrimmage, fumbles the ball. Michigan's got it. They stripped him and took it away from him.
A lot of talking going on down there right now, Keith.
Well, Michigan, there were three Michigan men there. I don't see how they couldn't come up with it, and they do. Ben Huff, number 53, looked to be the man who got it. So the Buffaloes turn it over.
This is just a straight handoff. Watch from the right side. That's a defensive back. That's
Marcus Ray.
That's Ray coming in, the strong safety on a blitz, a strong safety blitz, knocks it loose, and he may have been the one that recovered it.
Chris Howard is in the backfield now at the deep back position for the Wolverines. He has the ball, trying to bounce around and find some daylight. He fumbled. Colorado looks like they've got it. They do. So Michigan gives it right back.
From behind the offense, I'm sure Lloyd Carr does not want to see Howard doing all this dancing sideways. But it's just Black that comes up and hits him right there. Great tackle right on the ball. Black knocks it loose.
It's first down, Colorado, inside the 17-yard line.
Two turnovers for Colorado and the first turnover for Michigan. Inside the 20, Colorado this year scored 8 of 12 times. Six of them have been touchdowns.
Michigan still leading 3-0. Buffaloes are knocking on the door. Ball is given to Henry. He cannot get around the corner. Number 58 Hernandez almost was in his face by the time he got the handoff, but he got away from him.
Well, we came in expecting a lot of points, Keith, a lot of offense, and what's happened is the defenses have kind of slowed this whole thing down.
I guarantee you there are going to be some sore spots going home for both teams. Second down. Lepsis, the tight end, lost the count. Colorado's been in Michigan territory on each possession, but so far have failed to produce any points. Let's find out after the call here. False start. That was pretty obvious on the tight end. Here's Lynn Swan with word about William Carr.
Well, Keith, he came over to the sideline. The trainers are telling me he just got hit on his hand and he is okay. But at the moment, I do not see him back in the ball game. The bench area is pretty crowded and I can't find him there, but they're saying he's okay. He's not in the ball game, though, Keith.
He's still on the sideline.
Arenas, his replacement, doing a pretty nice job right now.
Second down. Pitch it outside. There's some daylight there for Lyndon Henry. First and goal, Colorado, with the Michigan 8-yard line.
It's a nice call by Rick Neuheisel. Things aren't working, so we'll throw in a little option. An option in college football, in any football, is a special play that defensively you've got to be ready for.
It is not a first down. It is third down coming up here in a yard and a half or so. His mark is put down just short of the 8. So it is third down. This is Henry. That's a first down. That's a touchdown. Colorado.
Well, you show pass over here. Michigan is going to blitz this formation right in here, and the ball carrier is going to go right up inside. Safety takes himself out of the play.
Jason Leslie is in for the point. Good. 11:31 to go in the first half, and Colorado gets on the scoreboard to take the lead over Michigan by a score of 7-3. Jason Leslie from Palacios, Texas, transferred over to Colorado from UCLA. He kicks barefooted, which means he's got one tough foot come November. Chuck Winters and Tyrone Butterfield waiting for the kickoff. It's a low line drive screamer going back into the end zone. Butterfield commits on the return and gets it to the 25-yard line. Next Saturday on ABC Sports, our college football doubleheader begins at noon Eastern. Ninth-ranked Notre Dame takes on number 7 Texas out of Austin. And then at 3:30 Eastern, Boston College against 11th-ranked Michigan, or other regional action. Check your local listing for the game on your ABC station, and the game is available from your cable operator. Next Saturday, right here.
So look at your quarterbacks. Dreisbach, 1 of 5. Field position for Michigan has not been good. Very conservative play calling back in their own territory.
Dreisbach swings it out to Clarence Williams coming out of the backfield. He's over across the 30 to the 32-yard line, where he's takes a couple of pops. Number 7, Dalton Simmons, the first man to get a piece of him, and then linebacker Ron Merkerson came along to leave a thumbprint.
Not a lot of yardage, Keith, but what that did is it's boosting the confidence of Dreisbach. Quarterbacks like to start off games hitting completions and getting the feel of the ball game.
Pretty hard to complete passes flat of your back.
Yes, it is. Or backed up in your own inside your 5-yard line.
Chris Howard, the deep man. Chris Floyd, number 7, is back there with him. Howard trying to get outside, trying to find the first down, and he comes up short. And here's a penalty flag thrown by the side judge.
Hannibal Davies on the tackle. Penalty marker on the play.
Must be against Michigan. Yep. Chance for you to explain the old illegal block here, Reese.
Illegal block. Well, let me show you. I'll show you. Can't have a wide receiver. You can't block below the throw below the knees. Watch as the receiver up here is going to come in and throw at the strong safety. He's going to throw low at his knees. Even though he didn't hit him real good, he still threw it. I think he did clip him a little bit.
That's the first Michigan penalty, and it's a big one. Backs him up inside the 20-yard line, where it'll be second down and 16. Chris Floyd is the single back. Russell Shaw is one of the wideouts. He's yet to see the ball today. And this is thrown to Ty Streets, who's got some room. And Streets is up just short of the first down. Number 7 wouldn't let him turn upfield. Dalton Simmons, and he's got him just about a yard short of it. Maybe even less than a yard, but it's still short of it.
Colorado's doing a nice job, Keith, of mixing up their coverages and defenses. We came in expecting a lot of blitzing and a lot of single coverage on the outside. Well, A.J. Kristoff, you know, he knows what's going on. He scouts his own defense. He knows what other offenses are going to try to do. He's mixing it up very nicely.
Third down, a short yard. Dreisbach hands the ball off to Howard, and he will have the first down. Actually, the middle was wide open. Dreisbach could have walked in for the first down himself, because the way the defense had split, it was wide open right in front of the center.
Take a look at the center, Rod Payne, number 52.
Nobody there.
He's going to come over and pick up Navies. Russell, number 16, takes himself out of the play. I'll tell you what, that number 6, Ryan Black, the strong safety, he will pop.
That's Butterfield in motion on the first down. Snap just over the 40-yard line. Howard gives that ball away. They're fighting over it still. It is Colorado ball. Oh, Michigan ball. I'm sorry. Michigan ball. The Colorado man had an arm around it, and Clarence Williams got down under there and just simply out-wrestled him and took it away from him.
Howard's going to take it and give it to the other running back who was lined up in the slot. That's one running back giving it to another. You'd think they'd be able to get that, but ball is on the ground. That's close. Jones, number 13, had a shot at it.
I thought he had it.
Yeah.
It's second down and 13.
Here they come.
In a hurry. That's early. That's a pass interference call against Washington. They belted Dreisbach hard, but he got it across there, and Ryan Black is the man that takes him down.
Well, this is a blitz. They're coming at him. Now, he's going to get hit just as he's throwing this ball. That's Black again. The reason the ball was a little late in getting there, if he had not gotten hit and the ball would have gotten there quicker, then it wouldn't have been any interference. But as it was, the ball was slower getting there.
Pass interference in college football. It's a 15-yard penalty and a first down.
There's A.J. Kristoff. Give me defense number two, he says.
Point of the foul, remember. So let's see where it winds up. Actually wound up from the first down marker just about a 3-yard penalty, but it's a first down.
They just gave Colorado a sideline warning. Yep. That means your players need to get back and clear that area of white on the sideline.
41-yard line. Nobody behind Dreisbach. Stands up quickly, throws to Woodson. He's the burner, but Colorado plays it very well. Still, he got about 5 or 6 yards out of it, even though they were right in front of him the whole time. Let's check in again with John Saunders.
Keith, Northwestern struggling again in ACC country. They have the 12-0 lead, but Matt Rader goes to Jeff Hodrick, 6 yards for the touchdown. That makes it 12-7 after the extra point. Then Steve Schnur is picked off for the fourth time this year, 6 times all of last year, 12-7.
I didn't expect it to be a cakewalk this year for Northwestern.
Nope, they're not going to surprise anybody.
No, they're not.
Second down, short 5. Chris Howard gets some company now with Chris Floyd. Has it, finds some daylight, and is close to a first down. Depends on the spot. Dalton Simmons made the tackle.
Simmons and Ferguson on the tackle for the Buffaloes.
That looks like a first down. But they will take the time and probably measure here. Colorado State, which had a pretty good outing against the Buffaloes last week, in trouble against the Oregon Ducks now. And Oregon lost their starting quarterback, Graziani.
Yeah, yes, it did.
But Perry Miller is in there, and he's pretty good. Ducks aren't a bad little team. It is a first down.
Michigan.
So Michigan chipping away, hanging in, hanging around, trailing 7-3, 7:46 to play in the first half in what has been a hard-hitting football game. I mean, there's people knocking each other around.
Well, the way they're hitting, you know, the Big Ten has always been known as a physical conference. Colorado would fit right in with these guys.
Yeah. The whole Big 12 bunch is a pretty good bunch of hitters.
Uh-huh.
Clarence Williams got the ball and does not get to the line of scrimmage. I mean, the Buffaloes knew that were coming. I mean, they were right there. Nick Ziegler leading the tacklers with some help from his buddies. Georgia, South Carolina. Robert Edwards is back for the Bulldogs and looking better. It's a showdown in the SEC at 7:30 Eastern tonight on ESPN. 7:30 Eastern time, 6:30 here in the Rockies. Robert Edwards, remember, he was the guy that just almost single-handedly beat Tennessee until he was hurt last year in the opening game.
Yep.
Then from that point on, he didn't come back the whole season. But he's special when he's healthy. You got a timeout, 6:53. to play in the first half, 7-3 Buffaloes. College football on ABC Sports brought to you by Chevrolet Trucks, the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. And Domino's Pizza, who introduces their newest crust sensation, Roma Herb Crust Pizza. Each team with a timeout remaining.
Michigan's run 8 plays on this drive. Gained 25 yards, but one of the big plays was that interference call.
Michigan's run 27 plays, and CU's had 23 so far. Drives back, gets heat, steps away from it, lets it go big. High screech is out there. Too long. Coverage on the play by number 4, Torrey Elton Davis.
Well, this is what they've been talking about, and this is what they've wanted.
This is what they got to have if they're going to win this ball game.
This is what you need to hit right here. Here's the strong safety, Black. It's going to be a blitz. Now, what does that give Michigan? One-on-one, way up here. Excuse me, let me do that again. One-on-one, right here. He's going to run right down the field. You got the blitz. You've got it picked up. Dreisbach steps up. Now you got one-on-one. You need to hit this. Give it a little bit more height and just hit it. Drift him to the outside.
Second down, third down, and the 12. Third and 12. Reach is knocked down over the middle. He was the man that Dreisbach won. His penalty flag is thrown as Dreisbach runs and gets down to the Buffalo 45. But that looks like it might be a Michigan penalty all the way. Olson on the tackle for the Buffaloes. Terry Turlington taking his time to talk about it. Make sure they got the right thing. Taking a while. Well, Dreisbach's clapping here, so I don't know, maybe it's going against the Buffalo. Holding? It is. Holding against Colorado. When you have that kind of a play, though, where the quarterback is back to pass and then pulls it down and starts running, it's very easy to get a penalty.
Penalties
call.
Continue to hurt the Buffaloes. Watch this as you're going to get, go ahead and run it. 4 receivers. Now stop it right here. Look at the receiver right here. As I go ahead and right down the middle. The telestrator's not working. I'm going to kick it upside the head. But right on the hash mark, going right down the field, receiver is open. He just couldn't find him.
Well, Ty Streets went across the middle, and Matt Russell planted him. He never had a chance to become part of the pattern. So the penalty against the Buffaloes. It's a 10-yard penalty. Ball just short of the 40. It is not a first down.
Yeah, Rick Neuheisel.
What was the call? Holding, right?
Holding, and that's automatic.
Defensive
first
holding, that's automatic. Yeah.
Should be.
But I don't think so, Bob. He's down at the 40. No, it's not a first down. Right in the first place. All right, third down and 2. They find four up the middle, and the offensive line surge is pretty good. But Williams got there a little late to ride the surge, and it's going to be close. 6:10 to go in the first half. Chains will come on. The Michigan offensive line of Denson, Payne, Adamy, Jensen, and Gwines is not knocking Colorado off the ball at all. I mean, the Buffalo defensive front is hanging in. By that much, I mean an inch. So again, the Wolverines keep possession of the ball.
That was Rick talking to his defensive coordinator, A.J. Kristoff. I don't know what he was telling him, whether to continue doing what you've been doing or maybe blitz a little bit more, or don't give them any cheap call. Maybe we'll see here. I'll watch and see what they're going to do.
39-yard line. The deep man, Williams, takes one. That's a pretty good tough run. I mean, that is a real tough run. First down, 11 yards. Iowa, let's find out what's happening with the Hawks. John Saunders.
Well, Keith, you just had a look at the score, 21-0 facing Iowa State today, and Matt Sherman having a big day. Tosses this one to Damon Gibson, looks to his right, then comes back to the left, and wide open for the touchdown. Iowa leads 21-0 on the 42-yard touchdown pass. Keith.
They might be pesky in the Big Ten this year. Ball is on the 28. Chris Howard in the backfield, the deep man behind Floyd from Michigan. Jeremy Tooman, who had a big weekend catching the ball against Illinois, hasn't seen it so far today. Reisbach throws it wide open as High Street. And inside the 20 to the 19. Not quite a first down. Boy, somebody missed an assignment, a broken assignment there.
What Colorado has done the last two defensive plays is just sit back in zone coverage, not attack, not come after with a blitz, just sat back, and Dreisbach did a nice job of finding the open receiver.
He was open already. Second and one.
Michigan inside the 20.
Hasn't been terribly efficient.
Hasn't been in there very much.
A first down as Howard punts in there. He's at 214 pounds. Clarence Williams is 196, and Mike Phillips, one of those quick-footed linebackers at 210, made the hit. Well, he didn't get it by much.
Stan Parrish there on the right with Clarence Williams. Parrish came over this year from Rutgers. He is the new quarterback coach. Got some fresh ideas to the Wolverines.
Change their own. It's first down.
First down, Michigan.
7-3, Colorado leads. Not much scoring yet. First time Michigan's ever been in Rocky Mountain country to play a football game.
First time, huh?
First down, Howard, the deep back. Now he comes up in the slot, and that leaves Floyd by himself as the protector for Dreisbach, and he throws it to him, and he's got some green in front of him. A lot of mountain air out there, and Chris Floyd's going to pick up about 6 yards.
Mountain air, I get a kick. Clarence Williams was doing an interview I saw last night. I don't know whether it was back in Michigan. There he is there, or it was out here. But they were asking him about the thin air. He said, I don't think the latitude out here is going to bother us any.
Williams is in the backfield, the deep man. Second down, 4. From the 12. Williams with the ball. Inside the 10, down to about the 7, where Roscoe and Russell put him down. At the conclusion of today's game, we'll select the Chevrolet Most Valuable Player of the Game from each team. Chevy awarding nearly $6 million for the scholarship funds of America's colleges and universities over the years. Chevrolet.
First down, first and goal at the 7.
16th play in this possession. First and goal, Michigan. At the 7. Crowd getting into it. Williams the ball outside. Back over there. Touchdown, Wolverine.
It's a nice piece of running by Clarence Williams. It's a great drive for Michigan, 16 or 17 plays. Watch to the left side of your screen, 16 is Russell. He does his job, he stuffs it up inside there, but then Williams sees well enough and has the footwork to bounce outside, and I think he was over the goal line before he fumbled that ball.
Of course,
Carr's not gonna be very happy about that.
Hamilton for the point, good. 3:21 to play in the first half, and Michigan goes back to the lead by a score of 10-7.
Just tough, hard-nosed football. Stuffed inside, bounce outside. Come by to meet you. Barely. We went back and taken a couple other angles of this. Take a look from the other side of the field. Hits the ball right there. It's from this angle, it looks like he was a little short of it. But this is cameras in the end zone. Here's the other side.
That's Rozga.
Rozga hitting him. Ball is out right there. That looks like the ball was out before he reached the goal line. All you got to do is break the plane, but that looked like it was a little short of it.
10 to books. 10 to 7, Michigan. 3:21 to play. That carries 4 yards into the end zone to Ryan Nunez. And the freshman comes whistling out across the 20. First down, Colorado. Tomorrow at 3 Eastern, 2 Central and Pacific, ABC Sports. Robbie Gordon and 11 of the world's top drivers meet in Michigan to take the final challenge of the International Race of Champions. And then at 4 Eastern, 3 Central and Pacific, Ari Leyendijk and the stars of the Indy Racing League will rule the dice in the desert at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. That's all tomorrow on ABC Sports.
It's a brand new track out there too, isn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty fancy, I guess. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen it. William Carr is back in for Michigan, number 96 in the middle, and Decker puts it out for Carruth. He's down. What a great catch. He beat Woody Hankins. So just like that, the Buffaloes are back knocking on the door.
Coy and the boys. Single coverage. Carruth with tremendous speed is going to catch this ball twice. Once.
Yep. Twice.
Twice. 52 yards and a great play. He's one of the best in the country right there.
27-yard line. First down for the Buffaloes, and Lyndon Henry is in the backfield. Carr almost popped in. Henry looking for a crack. Wolverines jump in right about the line of scrimmage.
William Carr on the tackle.
Detmer's got a great touch, doesn't he?
Yes, he does. He's got the whole package. Talking with Rick earlier in the week, he was saying not only does he have all the instincts, but he's got like a sponge. So anything you tell him some quarterbacks, you tell him early in the week and by the game time, but you tell him something in the first quarter, he'll have it by the second quarter or even before.
Each team with a timeout remaining. Second down, Detmer looks around, throws underneath to Henry, spins from one, pins the flag down. Gained about a yard on the play. Colorado man shaken up. Lyndon Henry is shaken up on the play. We're waiting for the call on the penalty. Here's John Saunders.
Coming up on Valvoline Halftime 96, I'll be joined by Todd Blackledge, who right now is hard at work breaking down all the important information for halftime. We'll also have the scores and highlights and be joined by Texas head coach John McAvin. All coming up on Valvoline Halftime 96.
Buffaloes have just hurt themselves again with a holding penalty.
What is that? 5 or 6 penalties against Colorado and 5 against Colorado and 1 against Michigan.
And they lose Henry for the moment. Lyndon leaving the field with some help after taking a double knock over there as he tried to spin and come upfield with the ball.
Neuheisel got some caught some flack earlier this week, Keith, didn't he, about penalties in the first 2 ball games?
Yeah, and Mau, wasn't it? Who was it?
Yeah, Mau, who scored the touchdown and spiked
the ball and all that kind of stuff. Everybody trying to tell Rick how to run his program. Ball is given to Troutman, replacing Henry, and they stack him up pretty well with William Carr leading the defensive surge. I thought Neuheisel using a line that his daddy gave him some years ago. Pretty good. He used it on local television this morning. He said, the higher you climb on the ladder, the more your rear end's exposed. So there's a certain degree of truth in that, isn't it?
Uh-huh. He's got this program in the top 5 right now, and they were in the top 5 last year. One of the top offenses in the country.
Third down and 15.
Blitz.
Down the middle. Get a man. Carruth. It's a first and goal for Colorado. Ray Carruth got loose.
Well, when you blitz, you go single coverage in the secondary. And Detmer to the left side of your screen. I think it's to the right. Yes, to the right side. Single coverage. They blitzed. Detmer knew that he had enough time. He got it picked up and threw the ball right on target. Here's a look at the blitz. Got good protection. Good job on the offensive line. A nice throw. Throwing it over Copenhaver and right on target.
Michigan calls the timeout. Carruth had been very quiet in the ball game up to this possession. All of a sudden, he's caught two passes for 69 yards, and he's got them knocking on the door. First and goal at the 6-yard line. Michigan leading by a score of 10-7.
Rick and his quarterbacks, he teaches these guys, and a few things he tells them. First, when you go to the line of scrimmage, think about your protection. What is your protection? Then look for the gimme, the outlet he's talking about. If everything else goes wrong, where am I going to throw it? So it's going to make at least a positive play. Now, if I'm going to stick with that play, now I'm going to look at the coverage and read the coverage. Now, am I dropping back 3 steps or 5 steps or 7 steps? Do I roll out? Check your footwork. And the last thing is obviously the snap count. But it's good that he breaks it down for these young kids, because the pros don't need that. But when you're young, just learning, you need that type of instruction.
He's also one of the few head coaches in the country who is a position coach. He coaches the quarterbacks. Detmer sets him up. Came up to the line, checked with me, and when he saw the defensive alignment for Michigan, they called the play. Handed off to Trappler, and they pound him down just about the line of scrimmage. David Bowens, number 6. You've seen him in and around the ball a lot. He's a very quick rush man from the end position. Time remaining inside a minute. Now, kicking along 55 into the end zone. It is touchdown. Phil Savoy in front of Charles Woodson. Detmer now 11 of 15, 173 yards, a touchdown and one interception. Rosga will hold it, and Leslie will kick it. Wolverines block it. David Bowen got in there, and this time he made his presence felt. And it's a 13-10 ball game.
That's a big
headed
point
for halftime. That's a big block.
Big block.
Instead of 4 points, it's 3.
He jumps right through the center guard gap. Bowen's number 6. Instead of a 4-point difference, it's only 3. Let's go back to the last touchdown. All the players are in here. Look what we got out here. One-on-one. If you're a quarterback, you want one of your best receivers. I don't care if your best defensive back is out there or not. Woodson, number 2, and Savoy. They just get out there, little hand fighting. And Savoy, who is 6'3 and 195 pounds. Makes the play. It's two pretty good players right there. And of course, Detmer, he sees what's going on. All right, let me throw it out there. Let me give my man a chance. Let me throw it where my man can get it. Outfight the defender. Just a good play. And a nice drive by Colorado after Michigan had gone down and scored with 18 plays. They go back and score in just 6.
Long pass. Detmer to Carruth. Set it up. In fact, both the key plays there were passes to Carruth. 51 seconds as Winters and Butterfield wait for the kickoff from Jason Leslie. So far, no rain. It's rained every day this week, I think, right about 4:40. That ball is kicked way down the road. Beyond the field of play. Return. The ball comes out to the 20. And Michigan's got 51 seconds to work with. No timeouts remaining. Colorado. Florida Buffaloes finished fifth in the final polls last season after their victory in the Cotton Bowl. And they started this year number five, and they've been stuck on five since that time. Matt Russell in today's ball game, incidentally, as he comes on the field, has 10 tackles.
Some pretty good teams ahead of them, too, there.
Well, you're right. They got no place to go. Even if they win today, I don't think everybody else above them wins. They got no place to go.
Well, nobody else is playing. Florida State.
Tennessee
and Nebraska. Right. Boy, looking forward to next week.
Floyd is a single back. Dreisbach gives him the ball. And Chris does a pretty good job with it. Gets it out to the 27-yard line.
that's not fair. Watch 16, Matt Russell. He sees it now. He's going around. Now somebody, this is like wrestling, tag team wrestling. Somebody hold him. Now you get him, and then maybe you finish him off. Matt Russell is the local comedian on the ball club. Practical joker. Keeps everybody loose. Four-year starter here for the Buffaloes.
15 seconds remaining, and they'll go to the clubhouse with the score remaining the same. Colorado 13 and Michigan 10 at halftime at Folsom Field in Boulder. So the point block, pretty big play. 3-point lead for the Buffaloes, and we check in now with our New York studio.
We here at ABC Sports are pleased to welcome Chevrolet and their collegiate scholarship program back to our telecast this season. Here's their general marketing manager.
College football players seem to be getting better and better all the time. And this has led to many exciting moments watching college football on Saturday afternoons. But it's what goes on Monday through Friday, the countless hours of practice, training, and hard work that helps make these games so exciting. Hi, I'm Jeff Hurlbert from Chevrolet. Just as athletes work hard to make the team successful, a lot of factors contribute to a student's success: studying, attending class, and conducting research. But it also takes money. And for over 25 years, countless students have depended on the Chevrolet Scholarship Program. This year, the Chevrolet Scholarship Program will top the $6 million mark in donations to colleges and universities. We're proud to be a trusted part of the college experience, as these donations have enabled thousands of students to continue their education on their way to becoming tomorrow's leaders.
Valvoline Halftime 96, brought to you by Valvoline, the number one choice of America's top mechanics. People who know use Valvoline. From our New York studios, John Saunders and Todd Blackledge.
Welcome, everyone. 13-10, Colorado has the lead over Michigan. Michigan very much in it on the road, although maybe they shouldn't be.
Yeah, Colorado really has had more breaks in this ball game, but Michigan is hanging in there. In a close game, it's always special teams and turnovers that can kind of turn a ball game. And it really translates into average starting field position. Look at Michigan. They've started their drives on the 17-yard line, two of them inside their own five. Colorado, on the other hand, starting on the 41-yard line, two drives deep in Michigan territory. But the difference, two costly penalties for Colorado has led directly to the points that Michigan has on the board. Michigan hanging in there on the road.
Should be a great second half still to come, 13-10. We'll get you there in a moment. But first time for some scores and highlights, beginning with the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame at home facing Purdue 28-0. Allen Rossum, a 99-yard kickoff return to open the game. Autry Denson with two touchdowns. BYU against Washington, and the Husky mascot fighting and ready to go. Rashawn Sheehy, who struggled last week, a pretty good game this time around, had a four-yard touchdown run. This one covers 45 yards as Washington led 14-0 at that point. Sarkisian came back with a touchdown pass, and then Shane Fortney on the option from 1 yard out. Washington scores right before halftime, 21-7 in this one.
Yeah, and a real critical score that time late in the half by Washington, because with BYU, no lead is safe. You got to put a lot of points on the board.
Yeah, look for Sarkisian in the second half to go to the air with a vengeance. 45-7, Virginia Tech blows out Boston College, a 12-game winning streak that's a school record and the second longest in the nation behind Nebraska right now. Iowa State against Iowa. And, of course, you would have the tailgate party before this one, the clash of the state rivals. Tavian Banks takes off 89 yards, cuts it back, and burst with the speed to the end zone. He also has a 13-yard touchdown run. Matt Sherman, a 42-yard touchdown pass to Damon Gibson.
Yeah, Sherman and Shaw, a very dangerous pass-run combination for the Hawkeyes, and just too much bulk up the middle on both the offense and defensive line.
Northwestern, a loser last week in ACC country at Wake Forest. Gary Barnett looking to get back there this time around against Duke. Steve Schnur to Brian Musso. And Musso does most of the work. Shifty move at the 10, then takes it in. 18-7 at that point. Duke has added a field goal. It is now an 18-10 game. Indiana over Miami of Ohio, 21-14. Chris Ditto, a touchdown run and a touchdown pass. Louisville and Baylor have hooked up. It's at 7 apiece. Jeff Watson, an 87-yard touchdown pass to Khalil Muhammad in that one. San Diego State in California, Tariq Smith, a 90-yard touchdown run, a 34-yard touchdown reception, and now another touchdown run from a yard. Colorado State in Oregon, Saladin McCullough, a 1-yard touchdown run there, 17-7. East Carolina against West Virginia. Marcus Crandall, 20 yards to Chappelle. Lamont Chappelle, 10-9 at this point. Now, he can kick the extra point and tie the game and send it into overtime, but Steve Logan elects to go for the 2-point conversion. He told me on the phone after the game, he says, "I've got Marcus Crandall, one of the best quarterbacks in the nation. I would do this every time." Do you agree with that decision?
No, I don't agree with it. I mean, it's tough to make the decision on the field, but Marcus Crandall was struggling in this game. Not over 50% completion. He threw 3 interceptions in the game. West Virginia played a great game defensively. I say you go for the tie. Your field goal kicker made a 47-yarder. West Virginia's kicker missed 2. Take your chances to win it in overtime.
Yeah, Steve Logan says he would do it that way again, but you have to wonder about that one. They come up with a loss. Back with more in a moment. Welcome to Valvoline Halftime 96. John Saunders alongside Todd Blackledge. Let's get to the scores and highlights, beginning with your former school, the Penn State Nittany Lions, off to a great start this season. Although without Curtis Enos today, he had a throat problem. Although the guys in for him played very well, but the defense did a great job. Brandon Barker fumbles after the hit picked up by Mark Tate. He takes it in 21 yards for the touchdown.
Yeah, this looks like a real old-fashioned Penn State team. The defense has only allowed 7 points, the fewest allowed in the first 3 games since 1973.
Fields and Harris, the replacements for Enos, 127 yards and 3 touchdowns. Auburn against Ole Miss. Terry Bowden should be smiling. His team hadn't given up a point all year. Plus, he's got Damian Craig.
Yeah, this kid is impressive. He can run, he can throw, and he's really dangerous when he gets outside of the pocket. You see the strength of his arm. But again, for Auburn, their defense, new defensive coordinator Bill Oliver, for the second game in a row, 4 interceptions. It led directly to 28 points today for the Tigers.
Robert Baker, that touchdown catch. Craig had 3 touchdown passes. Kansas State blows out Cincinnati 35-0. 32nd straight victory at home against unranked opponents. And Maryland beaten by Virginia 21-3. Tiki Barber with 123 yards rushing. Victory number 100 for George Welsh at Virginia. Next week here on ABC Sports, one of the biggest games of the year thus far, the Texas Longhorns hosting the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. Your former coach, the head coach of Texas now, John Makovic. This was at Kansas City. Now, I think he's saying, Todd, you think the hair's a little long? Yeah, coach, I promise I'll cut it next week and I'll play better as well. What was it like playing for John Makovic?
Well, John Makovic was a great offensive coach, really understood the passing game, and probably his greatest strength is his coach on game day, putting a game plan together, really knowing how to attack a defense.
Well, you had to say nice things about him because John Makovic joins us now from Lake Austin in Austin, Texas. His hair's a little shorter. Yours is a little grayer than it was back then. Did Todd have anything to do with that, coach?
Yeah, Todd didn't give me any gray hair. He was a great leadership and quarterback, and also he was really good with the rest of the players. He was good in the clubhouse and good on the field.
Coach, your skilled position players on offense this year, maybe the best collection in all of college football. Is one of your toughest jobs as the head coach figuring out how to spread the football around?
Well, it's not so much a problem. It's really a lot of fun, but we do try to get plays for everybody. But as many players as we have who can make the big plays, it's incumbent upon us to make sure that our game plan reflects that. The nice thing is the defenses have to get ready for everyone.
Coach, last year when you lost to Notre Dame in South Bend, stopping their running game was a big problem. Over 230 yards you gave up on the ground. Is that an area of the defense and an area of your team that you've really addressed for this time around?
Well, not only was it a problem last year, but we lost 4 defensive linemen in that game. So in the fourth quarter, we were playing with substitutes well down the line. We'll be a little better stocked. Fortunately for us, we're playing better defense, but it is a big key in the game. I think it is in college football today. If you stop the run, your defense is going to play well.
Coach, we know you like to pass the football, but I read recently where you told your coaches you had to get the ball to Ricky Williams more. What have you done to accomplish that?
Ricky plays fullback and halfback for us, but we wanted to create more fullback running plays in the two-back offense, where we go back and forth between one and two backs so that we can get the ball to him a lot. So we incorporated plays that come to him both in the two-back and the one-back offense. Even at that, I don't think he'll get it more than 15 to 18, sometimes 20 or 22 times a game.
The steady improvement of your team over the past few years since you took over the job is leading towards perhaps a national championship. There's a lot of people who think that you'll be in the running this year. Is your team good enough to compete for the title?
Well, I think we're good enough to be part of the puzzle right now. Only time will tell how everybody plays out. Of course, other games will be played as the season goes on, but we're good enough to be part of the puzzle, and that's where we want to be. These kids have worked hard to get to this position. A lot of them believed in us when we came here 3 and 4 years ago, so they've worked hard to get to this spot. I'm real proud of them. I'm real happy for them, too.
All right, Coach, thanks a lot, and good luck next week. We'll see you right here on ABC Sports against the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. Tickets for this game already going at 10 times their face value, but you can see it right here on ABC Sports at noon Eastern. That's pay-per-view on the West Coast at 9 a.m. Pacific time. Who do you like in this game?
You know what, John? I like Texas. A lot of skilled people on offense. The heat and humidity, Texas is more accustomed to it. And John McAvick will have 2 weeks to prepare for this game. Lou Holtz, only 1 week.
All right, let's remind everyone, if you missed a score, log on to AOL, live on AOL. Keyword, ABC Sports. Stick around. There's more to come right after this.
Valvoline Halftime 96. Brought to you by Valvoline, the number one choice of America's top mechanics. People who know use Valvoline.
Your second half is coming up straight ahead, but first a reminder, we already let you know about the Notre Dame game against Texas next week. That's at noon Eastern time, but it's part of a doubleheader at 3:30 Eastern time, four games of regional interest. Some of you will see Boston College against Michigan, a good one last year.
Yeah, BC played them tough last year, and this is a tough emotional game for Michigan today. Be tough to get up again next week.
Arizona against Washington.
Two teams, historically great defensive teams in the Pac-10, both kind of looking for a new identity right now.
In the ACC, some of you will see North Carolina and Georgia Tech. Carolina's been a surprise thus far this year.
Yeah, Chris Kelldorff, the junior college transfer quarterback, is really leading that team. They are the surprise team in college football right now.
And then for those of you on the West Coast only, we have a game out of the Pac-10, Oregon without their quarterback against Washington State.
Yeah, that's a tough loss for the Ducks. They have a great offense, but Tony Graziani, the quarterback, will be out at least a couple more weeks with a knee injury.
Okay, we want to remind everybody to check your local listings for the game available in your area and on pay-per-view. Right now it's time for the Burger King Scholar Athlete of the Week. For 10 weeks during the season, Burger King will donate $100,000 each week to 10 scholarship winners. This week's featured player is Andre Taylor from Division I AA North Carolina A&T. He has a 3.95 GPA in business administration. He also participates in peer tutorial group. Here are this week's other winners from Division I A, II, and III. Burger King and its franchisees are proud to donate $1 million to the general scholarship funds of colleges and universities in all NCAA divisions. Congratulations to all these fine student athletes. Remember, stop by your local Burger King restaurant for details on the college football scholarship fund. Stick around. There's still more to come. The second half is coming up right after this word and a message from your ABC stations.
We're at Folsom Field in Boulder, Colorado. Keith Jackson, Bob Greasy, Lynn Swan with you on a very pleasant afternoon and a real rip snorting, hard-hitting football game. 13-10, the Colorado Buffaloes lead the Michigan Wolverines, and the second half is underway as Jason Leslie knocks it beyond the field of play, and Michigan takes it at the 20. And here's Lynn Swan.
Well, Keith, I had a chance to talk to Lloyd Carr before he went into halftime, and he said he felt his defense played really good football, with the exception, of course, of giving up two big plays. He said on the offensive side, what they have to do is mix the ball up more. He wants to get the ball to Ty Street, number 86, in the second half. He feels very good that his offense can continue to move the football. Keith?
Okay, Swanee. And let's see who they send out here. Behind Dreisbach, it's Chris Floyd and Clarence Williams with Streets. Todd Brooks out there, and Tyrone Butterfield in motion. And it's Williams bouncing around, being taken down a little short of the line of scrimmage. Matt Russell gets his 13th tackle.
Here's a look at the numbers at halftime. Passing yardage for Colorado, 173. Michigan only 46. Total yards, big in favor of Colorado. Turnovers, Colorado has scored off of the lone Michigan turnover, scored 7 points. Michigan 3 points on 2 turnovers by Colorado.
Second and 10. Some time, goes short with it, picked off by off the turf, literally by Clarence Williams to make the play work some. And he'll have it out at about the 28-yard line.
The leaders for Michigan first half, Dreisbach 5 of 10, no interceptions or touchdowns. Williams with 13 carries, 38 yards. Streets has 2 receptions and no big plays among that group of receivers.
Third and 2 with Howard in at tailback. Chris Howard. He has it. Oof, close, but he's going to have the first down. He's across the 30. Ron Merkerson, Jr. out of Las Vegas. Took him down, linebacker.
For the Buffaloes, the defensively in the first half, look at Matt Russell having just an All-American type day, 12 tackles. He's been all over the place. Merkerson, the other linebacker.
That's a lot of tackles for Mau Mau, too, isn't it?
That is, the defensive lineman. You know, usually they're just taking up space.
First down for the Wolverine at the 30. Dreisbach underneath again to Shaw, Russell Shaw. We'll have it at the 38-yard line. So it'll be second down and 2.
Here's a look at the possessions in the first half. Notice on the start time, second and third drives for Michigan started on their own 4 and their own 1, and then the next one on their own 14. They finally scored on their 5th possession and then right before the half. So they really only had the ball 5 times and had it 16 plays and 1 score.
Nickel and diamond him right now. Second down and 2. Buffaloes took care of that one in a hurry, didn't they? Matt Russell and Ryan Olson. Olson 55, the primary force on the play. And there's a loss of a yard. There's a loss of 2 yards.
Michigan's game stories, we said they needed the big plays versus the blitz. No plays over 20 yards. Buffalo's doing a good job there, putting heat on Detmer. 7 hurries, no sacks, and Detmer played pretty well the first half.
Third down and 4.
Here they come.
Rolls out for the last time, and the ball is not good. Ruled incomplete. And so the Wolverines will have to punt it. Ty Streets was over there. Either he had no possession before he went out, and that appeared to be the call.
This is a one pattern route right here. One guy's out, maximum protection. His foot's out.
Yep.
And the ball gets there.
Yep. Good call. Fourth down. Paul Peristeros in for his 3rd punt. Both previous punts have been 45 yards. That snap almost got away, and it's almost blocked, but he's got a good kick out of it. Bear catch is called back at the 21-yard line. There the Wolverines will send in the defense, and the Buffalo crank up the offense. This has been a premium ticket for the University of Colorado Buffaloes ever since this game was announced, coming off the play game in
a couple
Ann Arbor
years ago.
2 years ago. But that game is now put to rest. That's the legend in the history book. This is all new people, new coaches.
There's only been
everything.
2 games in this series, and already it's kind of people think that, oh, they must have played. This was a legendary series because of that one play 2 years ago.
All right, Colorado to the attack now from the 21-yard line. So far, Coy Detmer has behaved himself. He's not been out there running bootlegs and doing those kind of things. That ball's thrown behind Phil Savoy, the intended receiver. And now he and Detmer are exchanging comments about who ran the wrong route. Here's Swanee.
Well, Keith, I asked Neuheisel about the penalties and turnovers in the first half, and he immediately got very positive and said, hey, these kids came back from the turnovers and played great. But he said for the second half, he talked to them about not shooting themselves in the foot and how to win this football game. He also said they've been staying away from Woodson intentionally because they think they can go deep on the boundary side corners. So look for it. Keith?
Yeah, that's Woody Hankins.
Yeah, that's opposite Woodson.
This is taken down on an open field tackle nicely by number 93. Michigan, Sam Sword.
In the first half for Colorado, Detmer had a good half, 173 yards and a touchdown. And the receivers down at the bottom got the yardage. Carruth with the 79 yards, and Savoy with a nice catch in the end zone. Lepsis had two, the tight end. Defensively, Ray, the strong safety, five tackles and a fumble recovery. Taylor, the other safety, the same.
All right, it's third down and 11. And Roy Detmer gets the ball away. The pass is incomplete, and there's a penalty call against Woody Hankins on Kidd, James Kidd. He hit him right across the head. That's what the call is. Two flags on the field. Roy Detmer took a lick himself, but so far he's stayed within his protection pretty much. Has not been running the ball. You just hold your breath when your quarterback gets running around out here, and Coy is a risk taker.
Well, Rick Neuheisel was saying, hey, in the offseason, we had him practicing sliding.
Pass interference on the defense. Spot of the foul, automatic first down.
I bet he didn't know how either when they started.
Yeah, well, he didn't like it. He hadn't been doing it much, but they are knocking him down a little bit. They put some pressure on him. That's the call right there, 23, and that's the boundary side. Hankins always into the boundary.
Detmer back, trying to set a screen over here. They get working, but then it collapses, and they take him down at about the 30-yard line, and there's another penalty flag. This time, I think it's the Buffaloes who get the call. The illegal use of hands, that'll back him up. It'll be about an 11-yard penalty.
Possessions in the first half, they had six of them, intercepted on the first, but they scored on the last two. Look at the start position, Michigan's 40 and Michigan's 16, so they had good field position. And all six drives crossed the 50-yard line for Colorado.
It'll remain first down for Colorado, but the ball is now back inside the 15-yard line.
A couple of those drives, Keith, started inside the 50. The other four across.
They were camped on that side for quite a while. First and 21. Looks again, throws underneath. Pass intended for McCarty, the tight end, and he's hurt himself. Edison McCarty has degenerative arthritis in his foot. I think that's just exactly what he's done. He's hurt an ankle or a foot on that play as he turned back trying to catch it. What he has is a very painful thing. Washington Huskies in Seattle at home, leading BYU 21-7. Frank, that surprises me a bit, because Washington got in trouble against Plummer in Arizona State last week. And
doesn't really surprise me, Keith, because you know, the weather up there is not very good, and that's a tough place to win for the visiting club. McCarty seemed to have just jammed his foot into the artificial turf.
Well, he has very tender feet, because of the bone right behind his toes has arthritis in it.
Yeah. Reaching back to try and make this play. That's Irons there, top left of your screen, right?
Oh, he
right
the
there's
ankle.
His right foot.
Twisted the right foot. All right. Tennyson out. He's the man who made that big catch against A&M a year ago here. Troy Detmer's looking, getting some pressure, passes away, and it is an incomplete forward pass. He's taken down, but not damaged too much by William Carr, who picks him up. Ben Huff, number 53, also had penetration, so that time Detmer's protection did not hold up.
Well, that's what Michigan wanted to do all day. Greg Madison, the defensive coordinator, said we need to put pressure on Detmer. When teams beat Colorado, like Kansas last year on this field and Nebraska on this field, the only two losses that Colorado had last year, they both put pressure on. There's Greg Madison on the right.
So it is third and 21. It is incomplete.
By the time the ball and kid got to their meeting point, there were three Wolverines there. And now Colorado will have to punt from way back in their own territory. Andy Mitchell, 37 and 39, but those previous punts, he was trying to place deep and was successful. One of them at the four and one of them at the one. Now he needs to stretch his leg a little as Chuck Winters drops back for Michigan. Didn't get it to turn over. And it goes out of bounds around midfield. It'll be marked out just on the Colorado side of midfield, a 35-yard punt. College football on ABC Sports brought to you by Pontiac and your local Pontiac dealer. We are driving excitement. And Burger King, where you can get your burgers worth. Chris Howard is a tailback. The previous best starting point for Michigan's possession was their own 35. Now they're going to start at the Colorado 49. Chris Howard is behind Dreisbach. They'll send the tight end, Tooman in motion. He's yet to see the ball today. He had a big day against Illinois. There's the first time. It's Mark Campbell. It's not Tooman. Tooman went to that side at a double tight end alignment, and Campbell was the man underneath who made the catch, number 88. He's a sophomore out of Clawson. Both of them are big targets, but Campbell in particular at 6'6 and 250. There's McCarty, number 41. Man who went out with the injured foot or ankle. Gain on the play of a yard. Ball at the 48. It is second down and nine with Chris Floyd, the single back. And time called.
Timeout. Michigan, first timeout in the half.
It's a Michigan timeout.
Here's a look at the last play. First play of the drive. That's Navy's number 8 linebacker on a blitz. From the blind side, Dreisbach never saw that coming.
Right in the old rib cage.
All those hits add up.
It can get a little hard to breathe after a half a dozen of those babies
in the
ribs.
That's why those guys wear those rib pads.
Yep. Tonight on ABC, brand new season for Second Noah, and you won't believe what happens in the season premiere. And then Tom Hanks stars in the movie that brings down the house, The Money Pit. All tonight on ABC. It's worth it just to watch that house for me.
That's funny.
Sort of reminds me of our house during the earthquake. Time remaining in the third quarter, 9:32.
Your house was shaking and baking a little,
oh,
huh?
Oh, was it ever.
Uh-huh.
And a million cracks. But we fixed it. Second down. Floyd, the remaining back.
It's single coverage down here.
Breach coming to the lower side. Pressure coming. To tip the ball and then make the catch and get a first down at the 31-yard line. Greg Jones had come in on Dreisbach, but Scott stepped away from him. Then Streets helped him out on the pass.
This is the old Bear defense, the 46, a little blitz situation. Had a man going down the sideline, but he didn't have time. Jones is there. Now he improvises. Streets coming across, just getting. Streets does a nice job. Knock it up in the air. Now, relax. There's nobody around you. He didn't know that, but got to catch the ball and then get upfield. Rosga's there again.
At the 31, a first down with Howard. That's the first down using the forward pass for Michigan. Nice box pass, ball down the middle, and he missed the man. He had Russell Shaw down there in traffic. The ball sailed past him. Incomplete.
Michigan continues to struggle throwing the football. And as we mentioned a couple of weeks ago when we did the Illinois-Michigan game, they lost both their wide receivers, Hayes and Toomer, two outstanding guys that went into the NFL. They lost their tight end, Riemersma. And they lost their big running back, Biaka Patuka. So they lost 75% of the skilled players that gave their production.
Chris Howard to about the 26. They'll need 5 more yards as Ryan Black makes the tackle.
Here's the top 25. Look at the first four teams are idle. Texas and Ohio State are resting today. Notre Dame played on Thursday and won. They won today. Yeah,
they're winning today.
I'm shook up. They play in Purdue, and I'm a little shook up.
You're just choosing not to comment. Williams and Floyd behind the clock. It's third down and 5, and a whistle stop them.
Timeout, Colorado. First timeout now.
So the Buffalo spend a timeout with 8 minutes and 14 seconds remaining to play in the third quarter.
Yeah, thanks a lot, guys. they don't have to. Bob Goodridge, our producer in the truck, does that for my benefit. We know SMU's 2-0. Yeah, had a big win against Arkansas last week.
They have stopped beer sales here at Folsom Field, and there've been two or three signs today with "We want our beer," but you can't get it. Once you leave the stadium, you don't get back either. You can't bring it back in. That's the Michigan schedule now. They've got Boston College, then UCLA goes to Ann Arbor.
Yeah, both of the next two games are at home, and then they start the Big Ten schedule.
This is a poll game for both these teams, really, for the attention of the pollsters. Ball is at the 26. Third down and 5. Floyd, the single back. Streets to the left. With Shaw. Here they come. It's away. The Streets is good for the first down, so Dreisbach was able to deliver the ball right on the numbers, and it works for the first down at the 16-yard line.
It's a nice play by Dreisbach. Here's a linebacker right here. He is blitzing. Now, this receiver right here is the hot man, and if that linebacker blitz, Dreisbach, the quarterback, has to see it and get rid of it. Sticks it to him, and then he picks up 3 or 4 more yards for a first down.
Howard is in the backfield again. Let's put it on the 17. That's really where it is. They call it the next hash mark, the 16. Russell is there. Fred Jones is there. And Mike Phillips is there. So they came in a hurry and they got in.
And they blitzed, and that's It's what Colorado does. The two inside linebackers are going to come here. The center will pick up one. Now watch as the back go to try and get around the quarterback to pick up the other one. Center picks up one, but he just can't get the back and get there. That's Floyd, number 7.
And it's second down and 16. Penalty flag as Chris Howard gets outside.
It's got to be against the offense if the referee throws it from that position.
So the Wolverines, illegal procedure. And after the sack, that's really going to back them up. But you got to take the penalty here.
Oh, sure.
Because Howard ran the ball down to the 12.
Illegal motion. For Michigan, 5-yard penalty, previous spot, repeat second down.
We mentioned the skilled positions for Lloyd Carr's offense being all new this year, the two wide receivers the running back and the tight end. Of course, Dreisbach, the quarterback, is relatively new. He started the first four games last year and then missed the next nine with a surgery on his thumb. So he's just getting back into the play again this year.
Second down and 21. Back at the 28. Pass deep for Streets. He delayed. He got the duck walking and started looking for the ball, and it's over his head and gone. He had one little bump and knocked him off stride, and he never got it back. I'm not sure that pass wasn't pretty well thrown by Dreisbach. Next Saturday, ABC Sports college football doubleheader starts at noon Eastern. Notre Dame against Texas in Austin. At 3:30 Eastern, Boston College and these Michigan Wolverines and some other regional action. Check your local listing for the game on your ABC station or check your cable operator. 6:41 to go, third quarter. It is third down and 21 from the 28. Crowd trying to help the defense. Defense did a pretty good job as they stifled Chris Howard at the 25-yard line. It brings up fourth down.
And conservative call.
Field goal try.
Conservative call. The Michigan just felt like third and 21. They had no chance to pick up a first down. Just don't make a mistake and get the ball in the center of the field to try to tie the ball game up.
If he's good from here, it will tie it. They're going to put it down at the 32, so it's a 42-yard try. He's hooked it a bit, but he's got it. And at 6:02 to play in the third quarter, we're all even at 13 apiece. All right, after the 42-yard field goal by Remy Hamilton, the Michigan Wolverines' Feely will kick it off, and Colorado will accept it with Lyndon Henry back in action. Remember, he was helped off the field at the end of the first half. He's back there in return posture now with Ryan Nunes. Nunes, not Nunez, I'm told. High kick going well into the end zone. And they're not going to bring it up. They'll come to the 20.
Colorado's had things pretty much their own way in their first two games. But in this game, look at the left column. Colorado, first two games, they've ran 88 plays in those two games. Today, they've ran 88 per game. Today, they've only run 34. And the opposition, Michigan, has run 51 today already. And time of possession, almost 10 minutes more for Michigan. And that is just the opposite of what Colorado has done. They have had the ball maybe 15 minutes more per game than their opposition.
Corey Detmer gives it to Troutman. Sam Sword greets him right about the line of scrimmage. Sam, a sophomore from Saginaw. Penalty flag along the line of scrimmage. Holding Colorado. The tempo of the game's kind of quieted down.
It has slowed down because Michigan wants it that way. They have offensively, they want to take their time in scoring. The last to drive nine plays to kick a field goal, they want to keep the big explosive offense off the field.
Oregon Ducks 28-7 over Colorado State. Colorado State spent an awful lot of adrenaline last week against the Buffaloes.
Holding on the offense, 10-yard penalty, half a distance to go.
Hard to jack up like that 2 weeks in a row. Eight penalties now for Colorado. They've had two turnovers and they've had a point after blocked.
Three penalties for Michigan, 25 yards, eight for 68 yards. And we're not through three quarters yet for Colorado.
First down and 20 from the 10. And Tennyson McCarty is back on the field after the sprained ankle. And Raquel Troutman just barely gets to the line of scrimmage before William Carr and a bunch of his buddies take him down. Woody Hankins, the strong side cornerback, was also up in that melee. Now McCarty leaves the field again, and here comes one of those burners. So they'll probably spread them out, and Coy Detmer will get out the long rifle here.
to Ruth and Kidd. Detmer with time goes to the sidelines, and it is incomplete, intended for Savoy. Defending on the play was Charles Woodson.
Colorado came in averaging 37 points a game, one of the top offenses in the country last year. They're going against a pretty good defense today in the University of Michigan. Michigan last year ranked 11th in total defense, third against the run, and in the top 15 in every defensive category. So
Detmer,
pretty good defense.
Detmer's 0 for 5 in this half. Same 11. And they can move around a little bit and take it down on pursuit from the backside, David Bowen. And Detmer gets up and spins the ball and walks away from it. Yeah.
That's Bowen's. Bowen's had 3 sacks a couple of weeks ago, and that's his first sack here today, so he has 4 in the first 2 games of the year.
That's good foot speed when you can come up that far from the outside and get the guy. So we'll look at it from the backside as the Colorado punter Mitchell stands right against the back of his end zone. There's no pressure. It's a low kick. And takes a Michigan bounce. It's coming back up the field. Oh, look at it! All the way back to the 32 of Colorado. So the huge bounce, that was, let's see, 5'10".
Bob Hawk, the off.
17 yards.
The special teams coach not as happy now.
17-yard bounce.
This is just, you know, Keith, as far as the field position, starting field position, the two halves are just opposite. In the first half, Colorado had the best part of it, and Michigan was backed up. Now Michigan's got the best part of it in the second half.
At the Colorado 32-yard line, Clarence Williams with the ball in traffic to the 29. Chris Howard back to the fray, bringing a play. Williams comes out, and Ty Streets is back on the field.
Second and 7 at the 29.
Michigan running game. Williams in particular has been pretty well controlled today. Howard has helped it though. He's the bigger back. Second down and 7. Right by. Gets time. Throws underneath. Pass complete to Russell Shaw. And Shaw gets hammered pretty good by Hannibal Navies. Al Michaels hosting heart stopping, they say, so take your nitro pills and a glass of water with you. A primetime special showcasing the greatest sports moments of all time. And Jim Kelly and the Buffalo Bills will be at Three River Stadium against the AFC champion Pittsburgh Steelers on ABC's NFL Monday Night Football right here on ABC. It is 3rd and 6 for Michigan. They need some yardage if they want to get a field goal. They throw the ball to Streets. Oh, did he catch it?
Unbelievable.
An incredible play by Ty Streets. And it's a first down. How about that?
Unbelievable.
Boy, I tell you what, Dreisbach better open the door and buy him supper. Both.
Number, linebacker is going to be blitzing. Russell 16, that's Black, number 6. Dreisbach gets rid of it once. It's tipped twice. Unbelievable.
So on first down, just inside the 15, this is Williams. Williams is all the way to the 6 before they can bring him down. And he just broke tackle. Marcus Washington, number 37, the cornerback for Colorado, is down, and it's timeout for him.
Take a look right here. Previous play. Watch this as Streets releases inside. The blitz is there. He tips it once. Then he knocks it over the defensive man who thought he had an interception, Rosga, and then dives for that. That's unbelievable. This keeps the drive going.
That could be an enormous play in this ballgame.
That's Marcus Washington. Torrey Elton Davis is his backup, a junior out of Boulder. And Washington is one of the primaries in that defensive secondary.
He was the MVP in the Cotton Bowl for the Buffaloes last year.
Here's Lynch one.
Well, Keith, you know, this is the first time that that Michigan has ever played in Colorado, so altitude was a concern to them. But Lloyd Carr took the time to call a whole bunch of folks, find out what they did for the altitude. He decided he didn't need to do a whole lot. They made sure they did a little more aerobic work. They hydrated because dehydration is a problem, and that's all. Right now, I think this team is in great shape. They've been playing very fast and very strong, Keith.
Looks like it.
Been substituting a lot, too, Lenny, on defensive line, especially.
First and goal at the Colorado 5. I'm sorry, second and goal at the Colorado 5. And I think the Michigan offensive line is getting a better surge now than they were getting in the first half as well. Ball is at the 3-yard line. And that's what gives them the first down. They had to get it inside before, and they've done that. Now it is first and goal at the 3. Chris Floyd, the big fellow who's been doing all the dirty work back there, and they finally give him a chance to stick in the end zone, and he picks up a yard.
Keith, Ty Street, on a play down here in the end zone when he didn't catch a ball, came up limping a little bit, and then in the last series he was in, he caught that pass, that ball that was bouncing around, but he came up and he grabbed his right hamstring, walked over to the sideline. He's not getting any treatment, but I think it's very tender. He'd be a big weapon if he can't get back in, Keith.
All right, second down and goal. Drives block, rolls it out. He can walk in himself, instead he throws, and it's touchdown to Jeremy Tooman. And you got a Michigan player hurt. That is Rod Payne, the center, down on the field.
Tooman is number 80, lined up right there, and he breaks free immediately. Could get him the ball quicker. Probably can't see him because of all the players in between the Dreisbach and the receiver.
It's a good thing that front foot was in bounds when he caught the ball, because the back foot was out when he came down. Payne comes off. Ryan Greasy holds. Bolash will snap it for the point try. And they're going to wait until Rod Payne, walking slowly, gets off the field. And now they go. Remy Hamilton, senior from Boca Raton, Florida. 59 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Kick is good. Michigan leads 20-13. So the Wolverines took the lead early on, 3-0. Colorado took the lead. Michigan came back to lead. Colorado took the lead, then they tied, and now the Wolverines have gone back to lead.
From behind the offense, another look at the, still a run down, so play action is still good. Now you see why he can't see his receiver right there. Now he lobs it up. Does a nice job, and Tooman gets up and makes the play.
Front foot's in, he's got the ball, but the back foot hits the line.
College football, just one foot needs to be in bounds. That's nothing. 7 points down with a whole quarter to play.
Oh, nothing.
Nothing.
Only the revealing thing you might have here is that Colorado had 233 yards in the first half. So far in the second half, they are -5.
They've only had two possessions, Keith. They punted both times. And they've not had real good field position in the second half.
Lyndon Henry and Nunez are back. And Feely hammers it. Both the kickoff people have been knocking the ball deep. This may be. Well, as long as you get to the 20, you're safe. And he gets it well past the 20. He runs it all the way out to the close to the 40-yard line. And gives the Buffaloes good field position. We'll be right back.
you don't come out when you kick the ball that deep, when you come out 5 yards deep in your end zone, but the Michigan special teams have not been that good covering punts and kicks. You saw it right there. He got it back out to the 39-yard line.
And Lyndon Henry comes out at tailback.
That's a great boost, Keith, for an offense coming out to start a drive.
Detmer, an option play, gives it to Henry. Wolverine beat him up. Sam Sword and Clint Copenhaver.
The key to this offense is Coy Detmer. There is no doubt about it. Look what Coy did the first half, 173 yards. Second half, he is 0 for 5. And they need to get him going. They need to make first downs, Keith. They haven't made a first down in the second half.
Yeah, Michigan possessed the ball a lot in that third quarter just by nickel and diming.
They made one first down. Michigan had the ball 22 plays.
Yep.
One by penalty, yeah.
They're coming. And sure enough, the tight end is moving around. McCarty broke the stance. Michigan players were pointing at him.
Dead ball. Ball start on the offense. Repeat second down.
Wait a minute. Now, if the tight end moves, he can move.
No, not once he's in down position and set.
No, Keith.
Well, I just flagged him.
I know that. Look at the two guys on the right.
Okay. The tackle moved.
All right, the tackle moved.
And then the tight end bounced around.
That was Melvin Thomas. That's the ninth penalty.
Underneath it goes. It's the roof. The arm block. And he's got a first down. He's right at midfield at the end of the third quarter. So the Buffaloes trying to crank it up after three with Michigan leading 20-13. We'll be back after this message and a word from our ABC station.
Time now for our Burger King College Football Play of the Day, and it's Brian Musso who hauls this one in against Duke. 51 yards, he takes off. Nice little move there, cuts it back, and then his speed takes over for the touchdown. 32-10, Northwestern is blowing them out. That's your Burger King Play of the Day.
Here we go to the final quarter at Folsom Field in Boulder, Colorado, on the campus of the University of Colorado, where their Buffaloes are trailing the University of Michigan by a score of 20-13. Lyndon Henry is the single back, and those speed burners are the wide people. And back goes Detmer. And he throws it underneath, and it's incomplete. And covering David Bowens has been all over the field, and he was in position. If his traction had held, perhaps intercept that ball.
Here's a look at what happened in the third quarter alone. Michigan outscored Colorado 10-0. They had 21 plays to 10, 77 total yards. Time of possession was 10.5 to 4.5. Now, Michigan had three possessions, and Colorado only had two. But that quarter was not good for Rick Neuheisel's Buffaloes.
Darren Shiverini is in there at one of the wideouts now as Detmer throws underneath to the tight end. Matt Lepsis, who has wrestled down after a 4-yard pickup. And let's get the news now on Rod Payne, the Michigan center from 20.
Well, Keith, he took a shot on the knee, and Paul Schmidt, the trainer, said it was about the third shot today he's taken on that knee. There's nothing structurally wrong with it. It's just a sharp pain. He should be okay.
Easy for him to say.
Yeah, Payne is the comedian for the Michigan Wolverines.
That's Matt Lepsis, who caught that ball. He's down on the field. No, is it Lepsis or is it Dennis? Looks like it's 89.
It's 89.
Yeah, it is 89.
It's Dennis.
But from this angle, it looks like an 88.
Yeah,
it is 88. But the front side looks like 89. It's Lepsis. He's caught three balls for 24 yards today. He's walking very carefully.
Well, you hate to see that.
One of the things that's been kind of surprising is Jared Irons has been very quiet today. He has three tackles. What are they doing that's keeping him away? I mean, somebody up front's handling him, huh?
Well, either that, Keith, or the Colorado's throwing a lot of balls downfield, and they're being tackles are being made by the safeties downfield.
Yep, they're going over him and outside of him. That is not a very comfortable place to try to run the football when you're up the middle against Michigan with Carr, Irons, Huff, and Sword. And Reines, when he was in the ball game, played very well too. Troutman checks in now as the single back, and they go double to the top of your picture. And boy, Detmer, this time, go underneath to Troutman, who will lose one. That one little side slip step there was worth 3 yards.
He is slippery.
Clint Copenhaver looked to have him right in his sights, but he just slipped away from him and picked up three more.
Let's just release Troutman out of the backfield, get him the ball in space, and let him do his thing.
So here comes Carruth with the play. Running in with him is Savoy, and James Kidd is the other wideout.
Fourth down and about a yard.
Fourth and one. Fourth and one could be big. Detmer to Henry. Get it. Wolverines played the option perfectly. David Bowen led the defensive surge, and the Wolverines will take over the ball at their own 43-yard line.
Just sound defense there, Keith. Greg Madison had the defensive backs up in tight bump and run on the wide receivers, taking that away, and they run the option, and the defense flows. Good defensive play. Six is Bowen's, Irons is 37, flowing down the line. Forces Detmer to pitch it. Bowen's and Irons are there.
And so the Wolverines make a big, big defensive play in this ball game. It is first down, Michigan at their own 43. Rod Payne is back at center for the Wolverines. They lead 20-13. Clarence Williams is the deep back, and the crowd's trying to help the defense. Williams with the ball, bouncing around, finds a bit of daylight, picks up about 4 yards, where Ryan Black makes the tackle.
Black is tough.
Ryan Black came here in 93. He was 5'10", 165 pounds. He liked Bill McCartney, so he sold his car. He borrowed $10,000. He left his home in Phoenix. He walked on here, broke his leg in preseason, missed the entire year. But he hung on, and finally he said to Coach Mack, "I haven't got any more money, Coach. I got to go home or do something, go to work." Coach gave him a scholarship, and he's the club's leading coach.
Oh, he certainly is.
He's a tough kid. He's got a lot of grit. This is Clarence Williams carrying for a yard.
There's a look at Lepsis. But he's got an ankle problem. Maybe have just had it wrapped again.
Yep.
Try and go back in.
Swanee.
Well, Keith and Bob, it's a what it is a sprained toe. What we would commonly refer to as turf toe. It's astroturf. This artificial surface can really grab your foot, and sometimes you jam your foot in it, and sometimes you get twisted around, and the ground doesn't give. But he should be okay, Bob.
It's third down and four. Chris Howard, the deep back. Spot, pressure, passes away, down to Woodson, and he got it on the chest and couldn't hold it. It was deflected. Simmons and Rosga were running right with him. But Dreisbach that time got it to his man. He just had too much company.
There's a look at the rush. Third and short. Man comes right up the middle and doesn't allow him to really get the ball. If this ball were out a little bit more and more to the Michigan side, the outside, I think it could have been complete, but that was pretty close.
All right, Brian Greasy is on now to pooch punt. He had a couple of good ones in the Illinois game. I like to kill it as deep as possible. It means you got to get it real high and you got to cover quick. It's high, it's a knuckleball, and a fair catch is called by Ryan Nunez back at the 14-yard line, a 37-yard punt, and no return.
College football on ABC Sports, brought to you by Ford Escort. It's new, it's nifty, made for the smart, the intelligent, thrifty. Brewery Fresh Budweiser, who remind you, fresh beer tastes better. And Chili's Grill and Bar, home of the Big Mouth Burgers. Colorado countryside reflected there.
Colorado in the second half has had the ball three times and done nothing with it.
Detmer drills it to Carruth, and Carruth is taken down at about the 16-yard line. Michigan defense is playing very well, has been through the whole second half.
That's the same play that they hit Carruth on earlier in the second half, that he made a nice run. Get your speed player coming across the field and hope that he can spring it.
It's Savoy now, wide down here at the bottom of the picture. And flag.
Ball start on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
That's concentration, or lack thereof. 10 penalties.
78 yards in penalties against Colorado.
Coach ain't playing either.
Yeah, but he's in control, though.
Second down now and 13. Detmer throws it, threw it very hard and high, and Savoy couldn't pull it down. You know, a year ago, or perhaps even at the start of this season, a knee surgery notwithstanding, Detmer probably pulls that ball down and takes off on that play.
Yes, that's a good point, Keith.
But his coaches have just talked in themselves blue in the face about, you know, save your body.
And there was someone that was partially open that he could get rid of it. You know, as you mentioned in the opening, last year, but before he was hurt, he led the nation in passing. But this is it. Lexus is back in.
Well, he retaped him. And there's some pressure now as they flush him. Now he throws it, and it is good. The kid, and kid's going to have a Colorado first down. So that's the mobility of Coy Detmer that makes that play work.
Exactly. Mobility does it. Go ahead and run this play. Let me show you where a kid went. Let's go back. Let's go back to live action. We'll get back to it in a minute.
First down.
Right there. See kid sliding to the inside of the field.
At the 37-yard line, Detmer stays with the passing game. The pass thrown to the sideline towards the press box side of the field, and Carruth stops, accepts the low ball.
But that last play, the completion that Detmer made, Keith, was just something, mobility, getting outside the pocket, and you buy time. You buy time for your receivers to slide one way or the other, and kid got open.
Nunez is in the ball game now. Both teams probably getting a little tired.
Watch out here. This looks like blitz.
Second and six. He got it away, and he is man. Boy, you give him that much time. So get it. Pass completed to Nunez. It's first down over midfield.
Nunez is the true freshman. His first catch of his collegiate career. And a big one.
William Carr takes himself out of the ball game for Michigan's defensive front, and Rob Renis comes in to replace him. Buffaloes moving the ball now at 10-13 to play in the ball game, trailing by 7, 20-13. Here's the blitz coming. Passes away, and this one doesn't work. It's thrown over the head of Nunez. And Detmer avoids being taken down.
Well, he saw it and was aware of it. They had the coverage downfield, and he avoided the sack and just threw it out of harm's way.
You know, Ben Huff has been pretty tough inside. He's a 273-pound junior out of Charlotte, number 53. He's played very well today for Michigan. Defensive tackle.
Used to be a linebacker. Yep. One of those deals where you
coach comes and says, good news, you can eat more. Moving to the defensive line.
Flag comes from the linesman. Looks like we might have our afternoon shower coming toward us. It's raining downtown right now.
Ball start on the offense. Still second down.
That's a 5-yard penalty, but it's just that little ding that keeps you in trouble. Keeps you from breaking out.
Yeah, that's the 11th penalty for Colorado. That's what they've averaged the first two games, so they've hit their average in penalties.
And on second and 15, Owens flushes it out. Oh. And he's knocked off.
Oh, no.
All right, tell me, is that a completed
pass? Yeah, it's a completed pass. Okay. Do it to himself. This makes every highlight
That's
tonight.
It. I'm going home. That's enough.
Did you say it started to rain? Is the ball slippery? There he goes, sliding out. Now he has a man coming across the field, and he has him open. Now this happens sometimes. You know, your hand gets a little sweaty, or the ball gets wet from the center, dripping sweat on the ball before he hikes it to you. Nice completion to yourself, Coy. You know, it was just nothing. He just caught it. He says, I'm just going to keep going here.
Well, he's looking at third down and two now. That's a big difference. And timeout is called with 9:44 to play in the ball game. And Michigan ahead by 7.
Updating BYU in Washington. BYU had been mounting a comeback in the second half, moving the ball fairly well. But Shane Fortney here, 29 yards to Dave Janoski. And Washington now on top by 17. Keith.
It looks like the Huskies are going to hang on and win that ball game. And we had a big rumble of thunder across the stadium a moment ago. So we've got a thunder shower sitting over our shoulder. Colorado's third down conversions, 5 for 10 so far today. They're at third and two right now. The penalty flag as Detmer rolls out and picks up the first down. Oh, they knocked the ball loose from him. I mean, they really belted him. And Copenhagen really popped him. But there's a penalty flag thrown by the referee back here behind the line of scrimmage.
It usually means offense.
Well, I tell you what, they sandwiched Detmer, and he's up walking around and all right. But hoo-wee. That's
Jeez.
Called a lick.
Rick's got to do something about the penalties. You just can't keep overcoming these penalties. I mean, in the close games like this one is, sooner or later it's going to get you.
Colorado, as Dave Burnson keeps insisting is a vital stat here, has not lost a ball game since 1989 when converting 50% or more on third down. Well, we'll see.
Jeez, where did you find that one?
I don't know. He dug it out of somebody's trunk. 20-13, 9:25 to play in the ball game. And Detmer back on third down and 7. Let's it go big down the sideline. He's got it. James Kidd, touchdown. It's against Colorado.
I like the call and I like the execution.
Glenn Steele is a Michigan Wolverine that is injured.
Keep this look over here. The in man on the line right here. Man on the right side of that line. Watch him just before the ball snap. He's going to move. And he's not set for a second. That's the tight end. Now, tight ends can move, but you got to be set for a second before the ball snap. And it's a good call. Left side of your screen. See, move. You've got to be set for a second.
Remember that. That's Tennyson McCarty, isn't it? That that has that sprained ankle trying to play on it.
Either he or Lepsis.
Lepsis, one or the other. And they both have sprained
ankles. Both. Yeah.
Probably hurting him, so he moved a little bit.
It's the fourth penalty this drive. I love the call. I didn't like the execution.
And it's third and 12, and the Wolverines dodge a bullet. Here comes Bowens. And Detmer gets it away. Pass is caught again by Kidd. And it's a first down.
This kid just doesn't give up. The attitude in the huddle is, well, we'll just go back and pick it up. Whatever we have to pick up. Kid goes downfield. Nice little slide to the inside. Detmer now buys some time between the linebackers and in front of the safety.
And it's on the 30-yard line of Michigan with 9:06 to play in the game. And Lepsis left the field. Henry is the single back. And Detmer steps away and calls time. Oh, that's what it is. The officials call time. And they move the chains finally, realize that, hey, that's a first down, guys. You got to move the chain. And here's 20.
Well, Keith, Lepsis is sitting on the sideline on the trunk, actually. He's got his shoulder patch off, an ice bag on that toe. So apparently that toe is bad enough where he is not coming back in the ball game. They are very depleted at tight end.
That's probably the reason he moved and caused that penalty.
Well, sometimes the reason you move is there's a checkoff. And if it's a run play, you have one stance, and a pass, you have another.
Detmer throws it complete to Carew. So Detmer keeps it moving. Take what you can get. And that's what he's doing right now.
The old quarterback right there calling the plays, moving the chains. Michigan looks a little tired. They've been substituting two and three players every play.
Irons comes over here now. He's playing what amounts to a defensive end position. Now he drops. Detmer throws it. Just about where Irons would have been. The pass is completed to Ray Carruth inside the 20 to the 17-yard line. And that's another Colorado first down. 8 minutes to play in the game.
Michigan taking time to get their defensive call in. They're sagging a little bit.
Troutman, the setback. This is Detmer's show right now. And they're giving him great protection. Over to the tight end, Cody Hepner. Hefner is belted out of bounds at the 9-yard line.
Hefner is the number 4 tight end, Keith. He's a redshirt freshman. They've gone through two of their tight ends, and Dennis, who was the 3rd tight end, has been banged up, and he just came back this week. Hefner was probably the 4th or 5th choice of Detmer on that.
They put it at the 8-yard line where the ball was fumbled out of bounds. And they're about a half a yard short of a first down.
The 12th play of this drive.
Michigan caught in the neutral zone. They tried to anticipate. And I think one of the defensive people got caught in the neutral zone. That'll make it a first and goal, if that's the case, for Colorado.
Well, the discussion is you had a lot of people jumping. The defense jumped, and the offense moved offside downfield.
Yeah, maybe Colorado.
Ball start on the offense.
That's 14 penalties, isn't it? 15 penalties. Wow.
That storm is moving through, Keith, is it you were talking about?
Yeah, so far it hadn't even dropped on us, has it?
No, the sun's shining here, the raining over there, lightning and thunder.
A little rainbow coming across
it.
All right, Troutman is the single back as the ball comes off that penalty back to second down and six at the 13-yard line, and Troutman has the ball. Then he is just leveled by Marcus Ray.
It's a great hit by Ray. Marcus Ray is starting in place of Steve King. King was the starter for a couple of years at strong safety. And in fact was the second leading tackler last year, but Marcus Ray has beat him out. He's getting a lot of playing time, and that's one of the reasons.
Third and one at the nine.
That was the first running play this drive.
Troutman again. And they've got it short of the line of scrimmage, and William Carr had the first hit. William Carr, the nose tackle, fought through the traffic and got him. And he got a solid lick on him, too, because Troutman's not a gimme. He's a tough guy at 190 pounds. It'll be fourth down and two.
There you go. Last time on fourth down, they threw a long touchdown pass, which was called back, so you've got to cover the wide receivers. Neuheisel and Detmer can just as easily pick up 1 yard throwing it to a wide receiver as they can as handing it off to the back.
Time called at 6:27, and it's raining. All right, this rain is falling. It is fourth down. And about 2 yards to go, Lyndon Henry is the deep man. The ball is on the nine. Detmer turns around and throws. It's right on the ground. It is incomplete. The umpire said the ball is on the ground. And Phil Savoy tried very, very hard to come up with that low throw, but he could not reel it in.
Here's a look at Savoy versus Hankins. They've been throwing on Hankins 23 all day. I don't know why they do this. I don't know why you turn your back and then turn all the way back around. You got to try and locate your receiver. Just step up and throw the slant or a hitch or a quick out. Now you want to get the linebackers blitzing. You want to pull them in so you can get this slant. That ball is on the ground. Ball's on the ground.
Yeah. All right, Michigan holds and takes over at their own 10 with 6:27 to play. And Clarence Williams carries. Nothing there.
Michigan has a tendency in these situations to get conservative, Keith. They need to make first downs to keep that offense off the field.
Tomorrow at 3 Eastern, 2 Central and Pacific, Robbie Gordon, 11 of the world's top drivers in Michigan, to take on the final challenge of the International Race of Champions. You'll see it on ABC Sports. At 4 Eastern, 3 Central and Pacific, Ariel Dyke of the stars of the Indy Racing League will be in the desert at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. All tomorrow on ABC. Second down and 10 for Michigan. It's Williams. And he's got about four as he wiggles away in the middle. Rain is not hard, just a little steady drizzle, a little more than a drizzle, but it may get hard here in a couple of minutes.
Well, Michigan needs a first down. Colorado needs a stop. Michigan used up all of their timeouts with their defense to try to get them a break and to catch their breath on that last drive against Colorado. Dreisbach is 13 of 22 and 108 yards. It's raining. You're in your own territory.
You lead by 7. Clock shows 5:20. It's a hostile crowd. Chris Floyd. Here comes Dreisbach rolling out to buy time. Throws. It is incomplete and almost intercepted by Marcus Washington. That was not a very good choice of where to throw the ball. He almost threw it right to Washington.
The problem here is the receiver just stands there and doesn't come back for the ball. The defensive back comes back for it, but the receiver doesn't. The young receivers for Michigan are inexperienced and not coming back for the football.
And so they must punt now as Peristeris comes in. Nunez is deep for Colorado. He's the speed burner. Michigan was short a man. Now they've got him. That is good.
Kick is pretty good. Into the rain.
Great kick.
Runs all the way back to the 31-yard line. Nunes. Back to the 41-42. If time permits, stay tuned for the Thrifty Car Rental College Football Postgame Report. John Saunders, Todd Blackledge, scores and highlights around the country. 5 minutes to play in the ball game. 5:01 exactly. Colorado with very good field position now. They brought a towel out now to cover the ball. The rain continues to fall. Four Eastern and three Central and Pacific tomorrow. Ari Leyendyke and the stars of the Indy Racing League will roll the dice of the desert at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway here on ABC Sports. 41-yard line.
Last two possessions, Colorado has turned it over on downs.
And now Colorado calls timeout. Well, you got this pesky little thunderstorm that just kind of taunting everybody and making things a little extra miserable for them. And
especially if you're an offense that likes to throw the football, it is a bothersome.
Well, Vanderbilt that played Notre Dame tough down in Nashville's given, well, that's early though. It's very early. Well, Alabama's offense hadn't been much this year.
Rod Dauhauer, the head coach at Vanderbilt, and Woody Woodenhofer, defensive coordinator. You get some good coaches in a program for a while, they're turning that program around. It's good to see that.
John Ralston still coaching at San Jose and so far winless. Hasn't had much success there. 70 years of age, I believe he is.
Keith, you hate to see that as Rick's going to go to a cap to stop some of the rain from going on his face. You hate to see the offense get the ball and then come out and not be ready to go and have to take a timeout.
Yeah, it's almost a waste.
They have one timeout left, but they have plenty of time. Time is not a factor on this drive.
5:01 to play in the game. Michigan 20, Colorado 13. No backs behind Detmer. No pressure either. Pass is incomplete. Number 6, Shivarini, diving for the ball. Defending was Charles Woodson, and they both had a shot at it.
He's trying to hit the slot receiver to the right side of your screen, but Woodson, number 2 to the top left, is going to see it. Watch as he comes in off of his man that he's covering and almost makes this play.
Yeah, he had the better chance to catch it than the receiver.
You get great vision, Woodson.
Second down and 10.
He's dangerous. They've been throwing away from him most of the day.
4:56 to play in the game. Detmer now gets some pressure, gets his pass away. Was Joaquin Fazell who came in and put Coy Detmer down.
Michigan has been using 5 and 6 defensive linemen, rotating them in there to keep them fresh. At the start of a drive, you normally see the defensive line play better because they've been on the sideline resting.
4:51 to play. Third and 10. Quick pop for the tight end. And he's taken down. That is Hefner. He's taken down at about the 45-yard line. They've got to go to the 49 of Michigan for their first down.
You got to hand it to the Michigan defense, Keith. They've held one of the highest scoring offenses in the nation, the 13 points. And Michigan's offense hasn't done much. And the defense has been saying, all right, go out there and hold it.
Andy Mitchell is in the punt on 4th down and 6.
This is a prevent here. You just make sure that he punts it.
He punted it all right. It's a howitzer. And he popped it into the end zone where Michigan will take over the football at their own 20-yard line. First down with exactly 4 minutes to play in the ball game, and that was a 55-yard punt. So the Wolverines now, the defense has done their thing. Now the offense needs to move it a little bit, pick up some first downs, and give them some rest.
That's the whole key here. Offensively, Michigan hasn't done much the last couple of series. They need to move the ball, not to score points, to take time off the clock and get field position for their defense when they give it back to Colorado.
Clarence Williams bounces outside, and Washington makes the tackle.
This is when you say, give me your best running play right here.
The Buffalo hurt on the play is defensive end Nick Ziegler, number 57. Next Saturday on ABC Sports, Notre Dame will be at Texas. That'll be at noon Eastern time. Then 3:30 Eastern, Boston College against these Michigan Wolverines. And other regional action, check the local listing on your ABC station. Give your cable operator a call. See what he's got to offer. Ziegler will lead the game.
Ziegler was playing in place of the defensive end Cade, who has been injured. Terrell Cade has been injured also, so he was a backup for Cade. Now they're going three deep.
Well, I'll tell you what, this is kind of a game, though, that's going to leave both teams sore.
Oh,
they
yes.
have really played hard. Matt Russell has 20 tackles today.
20. And he's looking for more. He knows they're going to run the ball, so he says, this is my kind of team. Michigan that likes to run inside, this is my kind of game.
Second down and six. Here they come, Matt. That time, Williams kind of squirts through there and gets a first down out at the 31-yard line, and that is very big. It comes at 3.5 minutes to play in the game.
This would be a huge win for Lloyd Carr. Took over last year. 16th year at Michigan, and his second year as the head coach.
Stan Parrish said yesterday, and a couple of the other coaches agreed, that they thought Carr had done a pretty good job preparing his team emotionally for this game. This is Howard, and Chris Howard pounding in traffic for about 3 yards, and the clock is running.
Offensively, you want to make first downs and hold on to the ball. And defensively, you want to get up and try and strip the ball.
Howard is down. So timeout for him. So the injury to Chris Howard, who just carried the ball, fortuitous for Colorado in that it stops the clock at 2:56 to play. Otherwise, they might have had to spend their final timeout, and you don't want to do that.
Russell, 16, he jumps over Russell. I don't know, Keith. I would guess he got hit in the side there.
Yeah, it looked like it. That's rubbing his stomach or rubbing his side.
Yeah,
ribs.
Yeah.
Hip pointer sometimes in those kind of
circumstances. You just get the wind knocked out of you, and it just takes you a minute or two to gather your wind.
The Colorado Buffalo schedule from here on, they're at Texas A&M on the 28th.
They have a week off before that.
And then Texas comes in here on the 26th of October. They have to go up to Kansas. That won't be an easy trip at Lawrence. And then right after Lawrence, they come home for Texas. And then you go on to Kansas State's always tough, but it's here. And then they go to Nebraska, November 29, where your average temperature that time of year is about 29 degrees.
And windy in the open booth that we'll be in, right?
Yep. Think of Jason Leslie, though, the barefoot kicker.
Oh, yeah, he better learn to put on a pantyhose or something.
Clock's running. Precious time draining away. Michigan 20, Colorado 13. Ball is on the 34-yard line, second down and six.
They need a couple more first downs, Keith.
Clarence Williams has been doing a lot of the heavy work here in the late going. He came puffing off a moment ago, then Chris Howard got banged up, and Clarence has to come back. Now you're looking at third down and three. Ball is at the 38. The clock is running. 2:05. It's Williams. That's
looks like a first down.
I think he twisted and turned just at the end enough to make it.
That'll stop your clock at 1:52, and it is a Michigan first down, and that just might do it.
Rod Payne, the center. Adamy, the right guard. Jansen, the right tackle. 77 is Jansen. That's Butterfield, number one, getting in there and bothering somebody. He's not big enough to block anybody. He's only 5'8". But there's Jansen.
Number 11 is trying to beat number 5 here in Boulder, Colorado this afternoon. The Michigan Wolverines. And it's Clarence Williams squeezing ahead to the 45-yard line. And there's a lot of tired youngsters down on that field right now. They're well conditioned, and they've held up well here at altitude. But it's been a tough afternoon for both sides.
But the thing that you want to do here now as a quarterback is make sure you run the 25-second down clock all the way down before you snap the ball. And Dreisbach has a nice view of it at the other end of the field, so when the quarterback comes up, he can get the ball snapped with 1 or 2 seconds left.
You see the time ticking away there on the right. Well under a minute now. Puts his knee down. No point in taking any punishment here or risking handing the ball away, because Colorado, with one timeout remaining, they spend it right here to stop the clock at 43 seconds. So two snaps and see ya.
Well, wait a minute now. We got 43 seconds. The ball will not start until the ball is snapped again. If he kneels down again, you can burn 25 seconds. That's going to take you down to 18 seconds, and it's going to be 4th and 6 with about 15 to 18 seconds. So you're going to have to punt it.
Or just run around with it.
Yeah. You're going to run around that long. There's a look at the top 25.
Colorado's the only surprise, isn't it? Well, I was a little surprised that Washington was able to handle BYU as well as they apparently
that,
have.
That didn't surprise me.
Yep. I bet Jimmy changed his defensive structure a little bit. He's running around. The clock's running. Now he goes down and 35 seconds. So that's going to bring up 4th down. Now at this point, yes, they're going to have to punt it.
Right. All right. That's what he was trying to do. Burn some time.
Michigan has had the ball about 8 minutes more than Colorado. And 20 seconds now. You've got 16:15 on the play clock. Play clock is just a little bit less. They're not going to punt it. He fumbled it.
Doesn't make any difference. You got to give it up anyway. So you got one play.
Yeah, but the one play is from the 37-yard line.
Remember 2 years ago, Keith?
Oh, I certainly do. I wish I was getting residuals on that play. you got 5 seconds remaining. Colorado's got one play. They got one play.
Is this weird or what? Look at the defense, where the defensive players are going. They're all going back near the goal line. You need to get jams on these wide receivers and pressure on the quarterback. Michigan is just giving up. The play is going to be made in the end zone.
Detmer puts it in the air. Tell you something, Carruth had a shot at it and may have even gotten his hands on it, but he didn't, and Michigan has won the game 20-13.
Unbelievable that they would come down to this. They had a shot at it.
Yeah,
look at the receiver in the back. Yes,
just not quite. I don't think I could have handled that one.
I don't think you could have either.
the Chevrolet most valuable players of the game for Michigan: Marcus Ray,
7 tackles and a fumble recovery. For Colorado, Matt Russell, 21 tackles. Chevrolet will donate $1,000 to each school's general scholarship fund to reward outstanding students for their academic achievements and to assist those in financial need. It's been a Chevrolet tradition for more than a quarter of a century. Join us tomorrow at 4 Eastern Time for Indy Racing League Las Vegas 500K right here on ABC. Michigan 20, Colorado 13 in a hard-hitting college football game.
This has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.
It's 5 o'clock. You're watching KMGH Denver. 7 News starts now.
Time remaining inside of a minute. Clock's ticking along 55 into the end zone. It is touchdown.
There needed to be more of that in Boulder today. It was the marquee game of the day with the whole nation watching. 11th-ranked Michigan play 5th-ranked Colorado. What everyone saw was the Buffs struggling to outpace the Wolverines. Good evening.
Thanks for joining us. It was a nail-biter in Boulder.
Let's go right to Geneva Brew with the highlights and the lowlights, I suppose.
Tough loss, guys. The penalties just killed them. It just absolutely killed them. Well, after all the talk of the catch and the play was said and done, the Buffs welcomed Michigan to Folsom Field. And it was the Wolverines who came in with open arms. Here's why. Opening drive, Colorado with the football. Coy Detmer takes the snap. He's looking for Phil Savoy, but finds Michigan's Charles Woodson, who fumbles, but the Wolverines would recover. The defenses were winning the battle here until the second quarter when Detmer hands off to Lendon Henry. He goes 8 yards for the touchdown, and the Buffs were up 7-3. Still in the second, Michigan answers. Clarence Williams taking over for the departed Tim Biakabatuka. He scores on a 7-yard run. The fumble occurs after he crosses the goal line, so he's safe, and that makes it 10-7 Michigan. Buffs come right back. Detmer, this time he gets it right. Savoy in the end zone for the 5-yard TD pass, and it was 13-10 Buffs at halftime. Third quarter, Scott Dreisbach rolling right. He's looking to the end zone for Jermaine Tooman, the 3-yard touchdown, and Michigan led 20-13. Now, this is a crucial play here. Detmer drops back. He throws a long one to James Kidd. He goes deep. Kidd scores the touchdown, but the celebrations came too early. Colorado called back for illegal motion late in the fourth quarter. Buffs trying to tie it deep in Michigan territory. They go for it on 4th-and-2. Detmer can't hook up with Savoy. Michigan with the big upset, the final, 20-13. Now we're going to have some post-game reaction from Mike Hafner. He's down at Folsom Field. Don't know that the guys might want to be talking too much. Probably a little upset.
Yeah,
upset
they are.
Yeah.
All right. Talk to you more a little bit later.
All right.
Now the last time these two teams met, well, let's just say you only had to watch the final seconds.
Time has run out. Stewart's throwing it to the end zone. The ball's in the air. Caught!
Yes, that 64-yard pass from Cordell Stewart and that catch from Michael Westbrook clinched the game for Colorado, 27-26. Michigan players were stunned. CU Buffs were wowed. Well, that was 2 years ago at Michigan Stadium, and coming into today's game, Michigan's coach says the catch is something his team just doesn't talk about.
There wasn't much talking going on at Boulder today, though. It was more like screaming from the fans, but it looks like it didn't quite work. 7 News reporter Lance Hernandez was there with the story about the fans. Lance?
It was a real loud game, Mitch, through most of the game. Of course, with the way it ended, things quieted down. You can see the stadium is emptying very quickly because of the big rainstorm. Now, I don't know how ironic it is that with the game that ended this way, the skies finally opened up. You're looking now down a little bit further below, a live shot of some of the Michigan fans that are leaving. They were cheering and partying up a storm just a few minutes ago, and a few of them still are. Now, few of those fans or few fans on the CU side would ever have imagined that this game would also come down to an almost Hail Mary miracle play. CU fans were pumped for this one.
This is just face, though.
While some diehard fans tried to secure tickets, others painted their faces with what else? Buffaloes.
He's gonna adjust my buffalo. He may be sort of more Picasso than.
That's right. I'm just going for the.
Than I would desire.
Out in the parking lots, people party.
Taste of victory.
Few
fans on either side expected to see a repeat of the miracle in Michigan.
I think that we're probably going to be ahead by about 14 when it comes to the fourth period, and Michigan's just going to trail the whole game like that.
Miracles happen, only to see you, obviously. But hey, Michigan, go blue.
Michigan scored first with a field goal, but CU fans erupted when the Buffs scored the first touchdown.
Kind of worried me there. Coy was a little bit loose with the ball.
Looking better the second half.
Oh, yeah, we're set. We're up now. We're up. We're never looking back.
You're looking at a live shot now. The last few fans leaving Folsom Field under a rainstorm. Now, the CU fans that I talked with said that they really didn't begrudge Michigan this win. They said CU had its day over at Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor a couple years ago. They think turnabout is fair play. They would rather their bus would have won, but they thought it was a very hard-fought college football game. Back to you, Mitch.
Well, there's certainly a lot of disappointment at Boulder after that game. We're going to keep trying to get inside the locker room there so you can hear from the players in just a few minutes.
Heartbreaking loss for the Buffs in Boulder today.
Indeed. Mike Hafner standing by in the locker room. Mike?
All right, Mitch. It is a subdued locker room. This Buff team expected to win every game this season, and they lose today to Michigan 20-13. Joining me is linebacker Greg Jones. And, Greg, this one is not fun to swallow.
We went out there, we played as hard as we could. They played a better game. We made some mistakes, some penalties that cost us, and, you know, not just the penalties, but we lost the game. We should have won.
What about the penalties? I mean, it's been a recurring problem over three games. Will you address that now that you have a week off?
We're probably going to try to address that. That didn't make a big difference in the game, so probably try to address that.
Did Michigan surprise you at all on offense?
They came out, they said they were going to try to run the ball. They tried. We did a good job at stopping the run, but just too many mistakes we made.
Can you forget about this and move ahead now?
We have to. The whole season's not gone yet. We still have the Big 12 coming in, so we have to forget about this and move on.
All right, tough loss today. Got a week off and look forward to Texas A&M.
Yep.
All right, Greg. Mitch and Ann, that's it for now from the locker room. This very subdued locker room. The Buffs face their first defeat of the year, and they're now 2-1. They get a week off and then go to Texas A&M for their fourth game of the season. Back to you.
Time to look ahead, I guess.
Thanks, Mike. Back to Mike Hafner. Mike?
All right, thanks, Ann. I'm with the starting quarterback of the Buffs, Coy Detmer. And Coy, this game was your way in the first half. Second half, they stuffed your offense.
Yeah, they did. They came out, and I'm sure they made some halftime adjustments on defense, and they came out and they played well second half on defensively. And offensively, they moved the ball a little bit. I think our defense played great today. They got us the ball whenever we needed it, and offensively, we just couldn't move it, and I take responsibility for that.
Penalties killed you throughout the second half.
Yeah, they did. Nobody's going out there wanting to make a mistake. Nobody wants to get a penalty. And everybody was trying their best. You know, everybody played this game wholeheartedly, wanting to win. And sometimes that happens when you're trying too hard to do things. And, I don't have any explanation for why we're having penalties, but other than maybe just trying too hard.
Can you bounce back from this? It's difficult. You got a week off. You can't play the next week to get this out of your mind. It's going to stick with you for a couple weeks.
Yeah, I think so. But, I think that'd be the worst thing that could happen is for people to jump ship and give our dreams up right now. We've got to rally and take this next week off and prepare for A&M. We got a tough game. We're going down to Texas A&M. They're tough in their own stadium. And we got to prepare for them and bounce back and try and get another win.
Was the game plan incorrect, or was it just you guys couldn't execute it?
Execution. You know, we got out there and just didn't perform. We didn't play Colorado football.
Coy, what happened with all the penalties? It just seemed like any time you got something going, you were stifled.
I don't have really an answer for the penalties. I think that everybody was playing as hard as they could, and nobody wanted to make a mistake. And I think that it was probably sometimes when you try too hard, you screw everything up. And I think that might have been what happened today, is everybody was trying so hard, wanting to win so bad, that you make a mistake here and there, and we'll try and correct that and try and get everybody calmed down and try and eliminate those. But effort was there today. Everybody wanted to win. Everybody was playing as hard as they could. and just execution was poor.
All right, Coy. Thank you so much. Let's go back to you, Mitch and Ann.
I think so.
All right. All right. Thank you, Mike. And we'll hear more about the Buffs' loss coming up later in sports. But tonight's Miss America pageant may be in Atlantic City, but Denver will play a big part in who wins, and you'll hear how.
And speaking of making dreams come true, that's the theme of the new movie Fly Away Home. We'll have a preview coming up next.
Colorado came into this game the favorite, and it wasn't to be today, was it?
It's so hard to believe.
It wasn't.
Let that slip by.
And the road just gets harder for them, unfortunately. They got a tough schedule. They really do. It was Colorado's first real test of many this year. The number 5 Buffs hosted number 11 Michigan. And the Wolverines came ready to take the top ranking right from the Buffaloes. To Folsom Field, opening drive. Colorado with the football. Coy Detmer takes a snap. He's looking for Phil Savoy. But he finds Michigan's Charles Woodson, who fumbles, but the Wolverines recover. The defenses were winning the battle until the second quarter when Detmer hands off to Lendon Henry. He goes 8 yards for the touchdown, and the Buffs were up 7-3. Still in the second, Michigan answers. Clarence Williams taking over for the departed Tim Biakabatuka. He scores on a 7-yard run. The fumble occurs after he crosses the goal line, so he's safe, and that makes it 10-7 Michigan. Buffs come right back. Detmer this time, he gets it right. Savoy in the end zone for the 5-yard TD pass, and it was 13-10 Buffs at halftime. Third quarter, Scott Dreisbach rolling right. He's looking to the end zone for Jermaine Tooman. The 3-yard touchdown in Michigan led 20-13. The Buffs only got 11 yards in the third quarter. Now, this is a crucial play here. Detmer drops back. He throws a long one to James Kidd. Kidd scores the touchdown, but the celebrations came too early. Colorado called back for illegal motion. Late in the fourth quarter, Buffs trying to tie it. Deep in Michigan territory, they go for it on 4th-and-2, but Detmer can't find Savoy. He can't hook up with him. Final seconds. Michigan just needs to run it out. But they fumble, and the storybook ending is just about to be written. Colorado ball, here's the drama. Detmer looks deep for the Hail Mary. But this time, the prayer's not answered. Ray Carruth can't get the handle on it. What an ending. Michigan upsets Colorado, the final 20-13. Let's go now to Mike Hafner in the Buffs locker room with some reaction on the game. Mike?
All right, thanks, Janine. And again, a subdued locker room, as I said earlier, but I got a guy here who worked real hard this afternoon. 22 tackles. Quite an afternoon.
Yeah, it was a busy afternoon for the whole defense. They played ball control with us. They kept us on the field a long time, ran a lot of plays, ran a lot of time off the clock, and they executed their game plan real well.
I thought at the end of the first half, the offense drives down, scores, takes the lead. I figured if you guys could come out, establish the offense, that you could take the game away from them. But they turned it on, the tables on you.
Yeah, they did. I really felt like we would put them away in the second half coming in the locker room. And, it just didn't work out that way. They kept fighting. We made too many mistakes on both sides of the ball. We have to eliminate the mistakes. And, it just didn't go our way today.
Can you bounce back from this? You've got a week off now. Look forward to Texas A&M.
Sure we can. Seniors are going to, provide the leadership, provide for the young guys, show them it ain't over when you lose. We got a lot of tough games left. I think if we had to lose a game, I'd rather lose this one than one late in the season. And we can climb right back up into the thick of things, and, that's what we're going to plan on doing.
The penalties. Can you address that over the next 2 weeks and correct them?
Yes, we can. We've just got to be more disciplined. We've got to think out there. We've got to really concentrate on fundamentals, doing the right thing, and there's no reason why we can't. And I'm confident that we'll get that straightened out this off weekend and going to A&M doing the right thing.
Janib, when you make 22 tackles on the day, these kind of things happen to you. Matt Russell had a busy one. He's going to have to keep doing it if this defense is going to stop teams and the offense can bounce back after the 20-13 upset against Michigan. Back to you.
That's right, Mike, and like Matt said, it doesn't get any easier there at Texas A&M in 2 weeks. They also play Kansas State, number 17 Kansas State, who shut out Cincinnati 35-0. Baylor edged Louisville, and Iowa beat Iowa State 38-13. To South Bend, Indiana, touchdown Jesus looking over the number 9 Irish against Purdue. Opening kickoff, Notre Dame's Alan Russom fields it at the 1, and you know what's coming next. Downfield, right up the middle, nobody touches him. He goes 99 yards for the score as the Irish fight off the Boilermakers, the final 35-0. Your top 20 scoreboard, number 6 Penn State shuts out Illinois big 49-zip. There's a Notre Dame score. Alabama is tied with Vanderbilt. That's at the half. Washington beat number 14 BYU. Number 15 ranked Auburn beat Mississippi. USC leads Oregon State 6-3 in the second, and number 19 Virginia Tech with a win over Boston College. Back in Denver, the Rockies were working on 7 wins in a row hosting Houston. And Coors Field, it's no AstroTurf. Here's a look at home run haven, but the Rocks didn't need those today, at least for the start of the game. Third inning, no outs, 2-1 Rockies. Ellis Burks sort of lobs the single into left. EY and Quinton McCracken score. That's RBI number 123 for Burks. It's 4-1 Rocks. Still in the third, still no outs. Dante Bichette pulls one down the left field line. Burks comes home and the Rocks are up 5-1. Guess what inning? Still no outs. Andres Galarraga hits a shallow fly ball, and Derek May just can't get to it. Bichette scores to make it 6-1. The score was 6-3 Rockies when the rains came. I'm told the tarps are still on the field, even though the sun's out. We'll have the highlights for you at 10. And here's a look at the National League scores. Cincinnati and San Diego are tied in the 11th. Pittsburgh and San Fran are also tied in the 11th. New York beat Atlanta in 12, and Philly beat Chicago. In the American League, Cleveland beat Oakland in game one of a doubleheader. Oakland leads in game two. The White Sox shellacked Boston. New York 3-1 over Toronto. KC beat California. And Seattle wins it 5-3 over Minnesota. And that's a busy day in sports.
Okay. It was a busy day.
Thank you, Janine.
Well, doctors say you could be headed for big trouble if you're still eating one of those high in fat and cholesterol diets. That story coming up in our health segment.
And it sounds and smells like Oktoberfest in downtown Denver. We'll tell you all about it next.